Oh my God, top 10 greatest horror movies. Finally, somebody got the memo.
The 10 greatest horror movies ever made.
So it's like the best horror movies, and then they're plus ones, who probably should pay full price for drinks.
I'm very excited to talk about our picks for the top 10 horror movies today. Whether I agree with them or not, we will see.
I don't know why I'm personally here. I guess John Roque is afraid of scary things.
I love horror movies because it makes me feel different than all the other genres out there.
Being able to experience something that's so out of this world and terrifying, but in the safety of a movie theater where you know it's not real.
We love getting scared, and then we hate the fact that we're staying up all night worrying about what's under the bed, what's in the closet, why is there a floating nun?
It's time to shine a light on one of the greatest genres of all time. You heard me.
You're live.
Been waiting for Beardo to do it. We had a deal.
What just happened?
Waiting for Beardo to do it, he blew it.
What happened?
Can you do it now, Beardo?
Horseman!
Supposed to start. That's how the show was supposed to start. I was very aware that we were live. Very aware that we were live.
I was looking at the thingamajig and I was like, I think we're live.
Beardo
guys.
And I were working on it. We had like this, he had this whole reverb thing, this whole echo thing that he was doing, and then it just...
Should we ask what happened?
Yeah, what's going on back there, Fred?
Did you forget? Yeah. Freddie Mercury, did you forget?
I wasn't sure about the cueing.
No, it's fine.
Sure.
Well. It's a good start, guys. Happy Halloween, everybody.
Yeah.
Welcome.
I'm surprised you didn't wear that terrible Predator outfit just to reimagine.
I wasn't going to wear a fucking thing.
Oh, okay.
But then Copster made me feel like shit. I'm not going to be able to do this the whole time. I'll tell you that
right
now. Yeah,
please,
guys,
take it.
It's because I can't hear you. I can't see you.
Yeah. All right, here we go. So.
But it was good. Yeah. It was good.
Now he plays it.
Yeah, I know. Where is it? So we'll do.
Holy shit, it's Kristian.
Back. I'll keep the belt on. All right. Much better. Much better. Well, I started with the costume and now it's over. Welcome back to Collider Lab. Happy Halloween, everybody. So joining us today is Mr. Mark Riley, Roxy Stryer, Josh Macuga, the whole Wangers crew. And I said it in the first of all, thank you to everybody yesterday holding down the fort. Ellis crushed it hosting yesterday too. It was a really good show. I listened to it on the way to the office today. I listened to some of it yesterday, and it was cool. It was a nice conversation about fast food, and I think that I would agree with Riley though about the In-N-Out.
Really, you love their fries?
Oh, no, yeah. No. Not the fries. The fries
are so good.
Did we include Shake Shack in there? Or no?
No. Shake Shack's gonna ruin people's intestines for the rest of their lives. It's just there's something about Shake Shack. I just don't
Shake
think
Shack
it's,
is perfection.
Really?
Yes.
I can't do it. Dorian loves it.
Have you been?
No, but it looks weird.
Is the shirt part of the Roca outfit, too?
Yeah, it's a
the black
shirt. Does he always wear wrinkles?
It was the only black shirt I could find.
Okay.
You're thinking of Steak and Shake. I'm talking about Shake Shack.
Oh, what's that?
Shake Shack is that like very awesome high-end fast casual
on Sunset.
Burger place.
Oh.
It's on Santa Monica.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, but you understand what I'm talking about.
So
that place up
fucking
there?
Fucking dump.
No,
so
yeah.
We grew up with Shake Shack.
You did?
Because there was one in Chestnut Hill right near me.
Okay. And then it went to Madison Square Park in New York. Did it start in Boston?
No, I don't know. Because it only actually, when I left is when it, like, I think I was 18 when it moved in there. But every time we went home, there was Shake Shack.
Yeah, because it started in New York.
So when? It would be a decade ago.
When did you graduate? When were you 18?
A decade ago.
Okay.
So I'm 27 now, so 9 years ago.
Yeah, so it started in New York about 10, 11 years ago.
Idiots.
Whatever.
Love
that's
it.
Good.
That's good.
You got it, dude.
I love it, dude. I love it.
Your voice today sounds very Phoebe and Friends.
Oh, it's brutal. Well, oh, when she tries to sing the song with her cold.
Oh, you should. Yeah, you should do
well,
it.
Roxy
some
got
smelly cat.
Smelly cat.
Yeah, exactly.
Poor Roxy. Roxy got hammered when she got in by everybody too. So people asking if she was stoned and drunk.
Well, Jack was like, "Oh my God, how drunk were you last night? Are you still drunk today?" And I was like, "Dude, I just don't have a voice." Christian's like, "Oh, you must have been baked." I'm like, "No." Everybody always thinks I'm high. Though,
yeah,
which I'm never high on air ever.
You have ever done it
one time when I was 18. And that was the last time I got high.
That's
before
an 18-year-old that was move.
Literally one time, and I was so fucking slow.
It doesn't work.
Horrible. For some people, it does. It's if it's your shtick and
that's
you can
true.
Do
if you
it.
Can do it all the time. There's something like some people
like
I know.
Benson.
My buddy Jason in college would play. He couldn't play basketball unless he was stoned.
Yeah.
What?
he had to play basketball, Stone. And he did everything Stone. I mean, when I say basketball, he had to wake up in the morning and brush his teeth Stone.
Okay.
So
my dad's the exact same way. Yeah, he legitimately can't accomplish things if he's not high.
Right.
See, it's wild.
I can't do it. I can't have a conversation with. I like to just kind of chill out.
Yeah.
If I'm being by myself, either write. That's what I used to do. I was telling Ellis, because Ellis was asking me, because you guys talked about the stand-up show for a while yesterday, and he asked me if I wanted to do a set on it, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't just go up there and wing it. Right. I'm going to write. But the way I used to do it when I was single, I would smoke a bowl, I would make sure no one was home, and I would walk around my apartment, stoned for like 3 or 4 hours, writing jokes, saying jokes, in front of the mirror, saying just, okay, that one, the timing there, I would work, and that was my process. I can't do that now.
Right, you don't have that option.
No.
If you don't have a time crunch, weed is the best thing that ever happened,
right.
Because it does allow you to be super creative in its own time, but if you have a deadline, you're effed.
No, unless you go see a movie or something.
Yeah. I will say this, my brother, I don't think I've said this on air yet, but my brother has cancer right now, and he is indulging in the weed situation.
Was he not
amazing?
Prior?
No, he liked to smoke and get high, but now, one of his buddies, because he lives up in the San Francisco area, one of his buddies runs a company, like a MedMen kind of situation, and he's giving him, the edibles, the mints, the gummies,
and he's taking it in.
I mean, he's just like, because the chemo's kicking his ass, and he has no appetite at all, and the weed is the only thing that's actually, kind of balancing out his stomach.
Yeah.
Chemo, it's crazy what it does to the body. You're literally giving your body weed killer, right? So there's these crazy side effects from it, and weed is the only thing that's like really balancing him out. So I was up there yesterday.
You guys smoked together?
Yeah. Oh, that's great. And he had these. They were like, those Hall's defenses, like the vitamin C drops. Yeah. He had those, but they were weed and they were spicy. And I had like two of them. He's like, you might need three. And I took the third one, and we were outside just looking at the stars about like.
Never let somebody who smokes more than you tell you how many you need. Because I'm sure two would have been fine. Yeah. You'd been A-okay.
Yeah.
I had that exact same thing with my mom. She got down to like 89 pounds and she was smoking so much, and she was able to like eat everything, ice cream, all this stuff, which is why anybody who doesn't believe in medicinal marijuana, I'm like, go fuck yourself.
Is it helping with the appetite?
Oh, yeah.
Good.
The chemo that he's on isn't going to make him lose his hair, which he was pretty excited about.
That's great.
But it's given him these other weird side effects that has like kind of just like shook him a little bit because he didn't know what was going to happen. But the weed has been a godsend. Like he said, he's only lost about 10 pounds, which is like sort of par for the course about at this point, because he just did his third infusion. And so it's kind of par for the course. But the weed is giving him appetite. We went out to breakfast yesterday morning. He had a full breakfast.
Good.
It was like,
damn, that
it
is
was great.
Awesome.
That's good. Really,
you know what's
really
been really amazing, actually, and hopefully I'm allowed to say this, but that company Ease, that they deliver weed to your door. Mm-hmm. So especially for situations like that, if you're feeling too sick to actually go out and get it yourself or whatnot, I used it yesterday because I was happening to feel lazy.
Mm-hmm. And you need the license?
And you can sign up online. You don't need in California, I didn't need a medical license. I just need my California ID.
Oh, that's it.
Yeah. Okay. And so you take a picture of it on your phone. You sign up all on your phone. And actually just, I click, whatever I want. It showed up 25 minutes later to my door.
Oh, my God.
Which was freaking amazing. So anybody who's unable to leave the house or like me, just a lazy shit and doesn't want to leave the house.
Basically, you just gave me my Thanksgiving plans.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. Perfect.
Well,
yeah.
I do want to say this too. Ben is a friend of ours, a friend of the show. He is family as much too. So
thanks, man.
Thoughts and prayers to Ben.
Appreciate it, man.
Gonna kick the fucking shit out of this thing.
Yeah,
And it'll all be good. So
he's in good spirits, man. It's sent a shockwave through the family. He's only 39 years old, but.
It's amazing you were able to visit him too, and you're able to be there.
It's nice that I can that he lives in San Francisco and it's not too far,
right?
You know, so but he's. I mean, again, he is the kind of dude that doesn't want attention. Do you know what I mean? So he doesn't want people asking me how he's doing and everything. So I just kind of, we just talk.
So don't bring it up on the radio.
Yeah,
oh, wait.
On a live show.
Don't do that.
But yeah, he's doing, he's just trying to kick its ass. That's all.
Good. You know? And
not trying. Just kicking
cancer.
Its ass.
And just beat cancer.
Anyway, and you also, when you were up there, you visited your other brother from another mother, Nick Scarpino.
I did.
From Kind of Funny.
Surprised the Kind of Funny boys and hung out with them for the day. They're just like us. It's like Collider North.
You can tell.
Or we're Kind of Funny South.
Dude, those guys, Nick and
you would love it up there. You'd have so much fun with those guys.
I'm going.
Too. It's
you should. Nick and Greg, when they were on, when they were, dude, Greg killed me. Dude, I mean, like, I knew of him. I had conversations with him before, and I was aware of how very popular with their fans and everything too. And I knew they were wrestling fans. But when they came on to do the match for the Schmoedown, that guy, I was like, can I move you here? Like, he would be, I would use that guy.
They actually competed?
Yeah, they competed against, they won. And they competed against
Greg's pretty good.
Rooster Teeth.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
And it was a good match. It was a really good match. But Greg was one of the best heels, like rivaling
Guy
and Roka. It was old school Roka. Like, and it
was. Roka's still a heel. I don't care what anybody says. Forever heel.
Forever, no matter what. No matter what. But yeah, Greg was killing me. And I even said to him, I go, dude, you need to be here because he's not bad in trivia.
Yeah.
He's amazing on the mic.
Like, Scarpino's okay at trivia.
But he's Greg got such good. A big personality, right, Scorpion, exactly. And they work so well together. So I love those guys. I'm glad that you got a chance to see them as well. But we're going to be talking a lot of fun stuff here, too. I'm excited at the 11:30 because we have Matthew Lillard coming in.
Oh, you
obviously know
him
from Scream. And
dude's a legend.
He's great.
Zoinks!
Yep. He's going to be on. I have a story that I want to tell him that I'm going to start with. I'm not going to tell you guys yet.
That's great.
Dude, it's such a bizarre thing.
Yes,
it's
a story
so weird.
About him.
Or? Yeah. Yes, it's really weird, and I'm gonna bring it up to start it off the conversation when he's in at 11:30. If you saw my tweet, then you saw that on this show there is one of us who's leaving Collider Live, and it was a pleasure to have this person on the show. It was a pleasure to work with them many times over, and.
It's me.
It is not Riley.
Is it Brett?
Is it Danish Christian Harloff?
It is not Danish Christian Harloff. I would never just fire Danish Christian Harloff.
Oh, no. Okay, perfect.
But I didn't
so
fire
much.
That person.
I didn't see your tweet then. Who is it?
I'm going to tell you right now.
Imagine if this is how I get fired.
Yeah. No one
that's
got
crappy with that.
Hashtag, that's the show.
Yeah, no Roxy. One got fired. This person came to us the other day and said, I got another job. I'm going to be starting this job, and I enjoyed working with the show, but I have to leave.
Brett.
Unfortunately, this person is Beardo.
Beardo.
Beardo's leaving the show.
Is it, are you being facetious right now? It's not April Fool's. It's Halloween.
Beardo, am I being facetious or are you actually leaving the show?
No, we talked about it on Monday.
Yeah.
What's the other job, man?
Audio editor.
Yeah.
That's great. Are you happy?
Good job.
Yeah. Thank you, Fred.
Fred Durst, thank you. Fred Mercury, Fred Durst, Freddy Krueger.
Wow, what a bummer.
Oh, the three Freds.
We just need the fourth
I'm
one there.
I'm just getting to know
Fred.
Him.
Or Freddie Rogers.
Yeah. Freddie got fingered.
Oh, right. So
well, yeah, I know. Well, we are sad that Beardo is leaving.
Yeah, me too.
But Beardo, we
did you know that?
I did. I knew it, and I totally forgot until right now. So I apologize. Yeah.
But Beardo, dude, I want to say
I blacked it out. I didn't want you to do it.
Yeah. Did you at least have fun in the show while you were here for the 3 months you were here?
Yeah, man. Thank you for. I joined like at least 2 years ago. I think the first episode was the Halloween episode.
Oh wow!
Wow.
And it's been fun. Thank you guys for having me.
Sure.
Of course. Well,
don't go anywhere.
So he's gone. Gone.
I mean, you know, whenever he's around, he's always welcome. Like anybody else who's ever been on the show.
But from all of Collider stuff.
Whenever he wants to come in, he's got a full. He's at two. Are you working two jobs
like
now or just
kid.
One?
No, it'll just be one. But it'll be a 9 to 5, so I'll be busy during the day, and it's in the middle of Hollywood, so that's traffic there too.
Yeah.
Is it good? Are you excited about it?
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm transferring. I'm promoting. Getting more money.
Got so, a boy.
Yeah.
That's what you should do.
These are all good things.
All good things. Congrats, Beardo.
Except
that's,
for us,
that's huge.
Thank you. Because you're leaving us. Yeah. But you know,
that's what I said to him when he told me. I was like, you got to take the gig.
Yeah.
You got to take the gig that you want to do. He's awesome at what he does, and they scooped up a talent. So
what are we going to do?
Well, I do have an idea.
Yeah, Fred, what are we going to do?
Well, no, I actually
figure it out, Josh.
thank you, Fred Durst.
I like Fred Durst.
I actually found the solution. It's a different solution though, because I don't think you can ever really replace a Beardo.
That's a line from Remember the Titans. You cannot replace a Beardo.
Oh, it is.
It's Gary
Burt's side.
Well, it's
true.
Nobody would remember that because no one ever remembers any fucking trivia from Remember the Titans. Everybody always gets crashed on it.
I would have just if you did a Remember the Titans only Schmoedown, I would destroy.
Me too.
Everybody.
I think
it has been kryptonite.
Yeah.
Is that the one with Denzel?
Goodbye.
Yeah. Is that Denzel? Okay.
Yeah.
If we do not come together, no, that's a terrible.
Right here.
Hold on. They're singing a
Beardo. Right now.
They're singing a Beardo.
On this ground.
Oh, somebody should do a speech to this. Roxy, I'm looking at you.
Yeah. I just tried. He told me to shh.
Beardo.
Because they're singing a Beardo.
From sound drops to.
And there's nothing on the screen, Riley. They're singing. From.
Sound.
I have to turn around.
Sound drops, I guess.
Yeah. No, I want to hear them sing the Beardo again. Oh, there you go. Perfect. That guy's dancing to Beardo now. It's great. I feel like that's the guy. I when I picture that guy in the back, you know, look at the gif of the guy going.
I don't know that one.
No, I don't either.
But what are we going to do? You didn't answer.
Because it kept getting cut off. What we're going to do.
Here's what we're going to
do. Yeah. What we're going to do, because you can't replace a Beardo.
You can't.
And Copster and Cody, we talked about it. Because I said, what we were originally going to do is, well, do we get another sound engineer? And we all agreed. You don't necessarily, like, the boys have, Cody and Copster and Alex, they will be now be able to run the clips and do all the stuff too. We just got to get them, like, you know, a piece of equipment that we don't have. And we'll do that. But what we did instead is that I had a conversation with somebody that will now be on the show 3 days a week permanently.
Brett.
Brett Sheridan will now be on every day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Okay. So we just kind of maneuvered over resources.
Okay.
And Brett Sheridan will now be on the show Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday.
Okay.
From now on.
Oh, so he's running sound now.
That's going to make it.
These guys are going to, Cody and Copster and Alex will be in the booth running the sound.
Got it.
Yeah, okay. There you go. Freddie. Okay. Kick it.
Is he very happy?
Brett?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was pretty excited. I mean, because it was, you know, the thing is, he just had to be, he drives from a while to get here, too. It was, and then we had to make sure, fans want him to be involved more. We want him to be involved more. We just had to make it work. And then Beardo leaving opened up a little more opportunity to make that happen. So Brett's going to be on the show more.
It's going to be much better for me scheduling, I'll tell you that.
For him? Yeah, I know. Yeah. So that's it, though. So, I mean, again, what I would ask you guys as fans here, make sure, show your love. Are you still at Schmo's Beardo? I know that you were going to change that.
No, it's still the same.
All right, at Schmo's Beardo, make sure that you you tweet to him and show him your love. Show him the support that he deserves. The guy has kicked ass for us on Schmo's. He's kicked ass for us here. He has been a really big part of this show and has helped tremendously. So we will miss you, Beardo. Thank you very much.
Beardo, thank you so much. Yeah. Thank I really you guys. Appreciate yeah, everything yeah. you've done. I really will miss you.
Hey, Beardo, as a personal favor to me, if you could just take a second.
This is about my brakes.
Yes. And now that you have a new job and a promotion and more money, please get your effing brakes fixed.
What happens?
Please.
Do they make noise?
No, they don't work.
Okay, that's
they do work.
That's bad. That's
I know.
Bad.
I know how to drive my car.
Yeah. You and nobody else.
Do you have a bottom? You're doing it like the Flintstones, or is
no.
it like?
Imagine you tap Flintstones. The brakes right me on a car, and the car doesn't stop. Right. But if you jam the brake there all the way in, then it.
Let's go to break.
Break stuff.
From the.
Town.
All right. So yeah.
I was just giving you background music.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, you got it. So Beardo again. Thank you. Brett will be on the show, and that's the announcement that we have now. So,
what did I say? Crowd.
Moving on.
I know. Yeah, it did. It's pretty funny.
Yesterday, yes, sir.
I have. What do you have? A very
a story. Now that Roxy I'm guessing.
Was, now that Roxy was singing this. Yeah. Okay. And with musicals, you know, I hate them. I wanted to talk about it Monday, but I was on the show Monday. I was on it yesterday.
Right.
Real quick story. I watched The Greatest Showman with my buddy and his two kids.
Oh,
they are 6 and 5.
Tell me you have only positive things to say about this movie.
We were up in Big Bear. The missus loves it. Amanda lives for the stupid Greatest Showman.
I think the movie stinks.
It's so good.
It's absolutely horrendous.
I think it's horrible.
You guys stink.
And a six-year-old said it the best. As he's watching The Greatest Showman, they start singing. He goes, "Why do they keep singing? They shouldn't be singing. This movie is stupid. Tell me when the cute girls come back." And he walked out of the room. Nice. I was like, that is exactly why musicals are the worst genre. And a six-year-old nailed it perfectly.
That's not
why are they singing? They shouldn't be singing. It's stupid.
That's You're
not,
stupid.
Yeah, to me, that's not why I didn't like the movie. When I saw musicals for me, I like musicals. But that one just didn't hit for me. First of all, from the real history of what that dude has done, not the best.
Is it bad? It's not good.
Oh, it's not a biopic.
No,
for
I know.
Sure.
It's not. But it also, I don't know, it was really dopey. It just felt like there was one part that was watching, like Zac Efron and Zendaya are doing
hot.
And he like leaps off this thing onto this rolling ball or whatever. It looks
sexy.
It looks so dumb. I literally watched it and went, "Wee!"
Yeah,
because it looks so dumb.
It looks so good.
I hate that
movie. The music's amazing.
I've never seen the movie.
You're going to love it.
Do I? Yeah. Is it so bad that I need to watch? I mean, people are loving the music.
No, you have to see it. You're going to love it. Julie's going to love it.
Okay. You legitimately can understand the movie from the trailer. You watch the whole movie in the trailer.
There are people who like this movie.
So
look,
good.
Roca,
the movie is
Brianne, Roxy. There are a lot of people who really
Ben Bateman. Unbelievable.
One of his favorite movies.
Unbelievable.
It's unbelievable.
It's not an unbelievable movie.
That movie
it's unbelievable.
Is the
you
most
think it's
unbelievably stupid fucking cookie cutter musical BS I've ever
this
watched.
This is what's so funny.
That's insane.
We can rent it, right? And I go, babe, to my fiance. Yeah. Do you want to watch this musical? All the people she likes. She's like, sure. Let's watch the trailer. Halfway through the trailer, she went, no, I don't want to.
Yeah.
Kristian, do you like musicals?
So I do like musicals a lot.
Okay. And Riley, you like musicals?
I like musicals.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I hate musicals, and it was on the background. Yeah. My lady was watching. I'm like, it's not awful, but it's not great either.
Yeah, but if you the background thing, I was invested trying to watch the movie. That's the problem.
It's so good.
Alex loved it though.
Here, you would just
Alex, a lot
Alex,
of people do.
Did you love it?
I fucking loved it.
Oh, okay. Alex.
I think that's dramatic.
Yeah, but Alex is like a musical savant, so he likes
music. About Alex?
What?
Alex and I went to lunch on Monday with Josh. Yeah. And Alex had two beers at lunch.
Yeah. He's a little alky.
I was kind of surprised by that. Yeah.
He's also like 17 years old. Yeah. He's got to steal beers right now.
No, you know what the funny thing is? He's actually probably like 63. Yeah. But we don't know because he's in shit-faced at comedy clubs. He's getting hammered at lunch. What's going on?
He for sure got ID'd. And she looked at him like, I'm not serving you. And then he handed it and she was like,
Amanda, our server. He also played one of his songs. Have you ever heard one of his
songs? He's a great singer.
Yeah, he's fucking unreal.
He's awesome.
Unreal.
Really good.
He's really good.
Wait, Alex, when are you going to invite us to an actual gig?
Yeah.
I haven't had a show in 2 years.
Oh, that's good.
But I'm hoping to start something new in 2019.
Well, you know what? I got it. No, I got it. Wait, I got it. So we're going to set up a gig for you. And opening for you will be John Rocha. John Rocha will open and sing songs too.
This is great.
He'll sing.
Of course he will.
I want to come.
Yeah. Yeah, all right.
Can I do something?
You're always invited.
But you can actually sing, though.
I could try.
I knew you could sing.
Yeah.
From the town.
Crowd of bed rock.
Yeah.
Do you actually sing the right lyrics?
Yeah, growing up I did. Then I got 7 nodules, which is why I sound like a horse's man.
A horse's man?
Yeah, I don't know.
A man horse?
A man horse?
Oh, which reminds me, by the way.
There's a horse's man, just a man.
No, yesterday you had never heard anybody say, I crawled into bed?
I guess not.
Right?
I think I've heard it with drunk people. Oh, I fucking crawled into bed.
Or sick. Like, I was so sick, I said to crawl into bed.
But he was like, I was with my lady, we crawled into bed.
Right.
That didn't feel like a crawl. Huh.
It was like...
He used it wrong, but it is a saying.
But I think I've heard
it. What the fuck is wrong with using crawl and then it being used wrong? What are you people doing?
You see, understand why it's fun sometimes? That's what I'm saying. So why are you in a bad mood?
Here's the thing, though. I literally today... Here's why it pissed me off so much today. Okay.
So you were in a bad mood.
No. I'll tell you.
All right.
I was in my
this is why I retired as Captain America. I can't take the fighting.
Yesterday we're sitting here, and Ellis even said to me, he was like, you're in a good mood. And I was like, Kristian never tells me I'm in a good mood. So then I was in the car driving here this morning, and I was listening to podcasts, and I said, fuck this. I'm going to listen to disco.
Because
I was like really trying to, whatever. And so I'm in my car. I'm singing along. I'm sounding like shit because my throat. And oh yeah, exactly. And I'm really like jamming. And I was like, Christian's gonna ask me today why I'm in such a good mood. He's gonna ask me because I'm in the best mood. And I walked in.
You know, I'm never gonna ask you if you're in a good mood now.
I walked in. What was the first fucking thing he said to me? What's up, Ric Flair?
Well, she looks like Flair. I should have said Charlotte Flair, but
so
I went to Ric.
So I was like, okay. And then I'm like, go get your hot water. He's gonna ask you why you're in a good mood. You're gonna keep smiling. Get in here, Christian. So why are you in such a crap mood?
I didn't say it like that. That's not what I said. I don't think that I said it to you over there, too. I asked you if you were high yesterday. That's what I asked.
Yeah, so then you asked me that, and I still tried to smile through it. Then you asked, why are you so grouchy?
I said, are you grouchy? I didn't say, why are you
grouchy? What is are you grouchy?
There's a difference, because I said, are you grouchy?
Obviously, if you have to ask somebody if they're grouchy, it's because they're being grouchy.
Sometimes when people say to me, are you in a good mood or in a bad mood, I go, no, I'm fucking pissed. It wasn't like, you seem pissed, why are you pissed?
But sometimes I say, no, I'm in a bad mood.
Right.
But I was in a really good mood.
Well, that's why, again, I tiptoed around.
But why'd you ask if I was grouchy?
He seems grouchy to me.
Why did I seem grouchy?
I don't know. It's
probably
because
you called me Ric Flair and asked if I was stoned.
Wait a minute. The Ric Flair part of it, you're in a Ric Flair-esque robe.
Kind of.
So, and
it's more
got,
like a wizard.
You look more like Charlotte Flair.
So
I'll go back.
Yeah,
I'll
kind
go
of
back
look
to
like
Charlotte
an imitation psychic reader.
Thank you so much.
And that doesn't piss you off?
It's Halloween. See? Now, honestly...
What was it about me that pissed you off today?
Yeah, that's the thing.
That's what it was.
About Macuga doesn't piss me off like you do.
What am I pissing you off about?
I don't know.
So what is that? No, we got to get to the bottom of this.
Because after Josh insults me, he puts on that laugh
and
smile that he just did.
You seem like I'm still pissed at you or something.
Well, you hit it where it hurts.
By calling you Ric Flair?
Oh,
you feel like you look like Ric Flair?
Maybe.
Was that what it is? Have you had a Ric Flair
it's
complex?
It's not that specific one. Just there's something about the way that you come off. I'm like, ooh, Kristian fucking hit it that
time.
It's
the East Coast.
Yeah, maybe.
It is.
Maybe. And well, it's East Coast.
He sure knows how to take a nail and just tick, tick, tick.
Like, yeah.
It's like right in you.
Ticks
and
you away at it. It's a
did
good,
I do that to you?
It's a good skill to have.
It's so funny because I saw that comment yesterday and I actually really liked it. And someone I think wanted to do the opposite effect to me.
Yeah.
And they said, like, I like this show. It doesn't seem angry in the studio. And I go, well, wait till tomorrow, fuckface. Some of the bitches. It's like, I'm so over the fucking comments sometimes, too. It's just like, you know.
Oh, I can't
so
imagine
you
why.
You listened to the show when you weren't here.
I did. Well, I listened to it. I listened to a lot of it yesterday live when. Because you guys had Roke on, my wife and I were listening to it a little bit when we went out. Because yesterday was my anniversary.
So you're with your wife. Yeah, ah.
Well, I said I would talk about it.
8 years?
What? 8 years from when we were married. We were together 11.
Whoa. Why do people only say from when they got married? Why?
I say 11. I say
yeah,
11 because
11
that's
years.
How long we've been together. But you know, the married date themselves, because that's the real commitment when you decide that's it.
I feel like the last time you slept with somebody is how long you've been with somebody else.
Right. Well, that's true. So yeah, it's been 12 years. So I've been together with someone for 12. Yeah. 11 or 12.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
That's great.
That's amazing. What did you guys do?
We went to, we had breakfast. We had the baby with us the whole time. Nice. So we had breakfast. The baby took a nap, went out to lunch, had
you
some lunch.
You made breakfast?
Made breakfast. And then my wife started the tomato sauce
early.
We had tomatoes and meatballs. I helped her make the meatballs. And then we went out to lunch, had a nice meal. And then I took her to get a little gift. And then
nice.
Another Fitbit?
Not a Fitbit this time. No, I delivered yesterday.
What'd you get? Trust me.
I don't want to say in the air. I'll tell you afterwards what we did.
He got jewelry.
Is it sexy?
Yeah.
No, not sexy. It's just something that, just some
personal.
A little more personal. Personal that I can share with the friends.
Friend, yeah.
It's a good move, dude. Like, taking her, like, did you take her? And
yeah.
Be like,
yeah.
Well,
we went, again, it was right in the same area where we did. We had a nice time. We hung out with the little one. And then my other daughter got back. We all had the meatballs and the sauce. Had a nice.
Your wife makes an incredible.
She really
good
does,
sauce.
And she's
oh
been
never been invited.
Not yet. You haven't.
It's only been happened.
We're only gonna. We talked about it though yesterday, Roxy. We talked about.
Roxy's always invited.
Well, yeah, we
right?
talked about Roxy yesterday, and we said that when Roxy's in a good mood, we'll invite her.
Damn it.
Hey.
Sadie would never say that about me.
No, she likes you now.
I like her.
Amazing. But yeah, so we listened to the show, and I was listening to the part that we listened to was the Roka part and everything, too. Kind of, he took it well because people were.
He does take it well.
But they were doing it. Yeah. But they were doing it yesterday. I would also say I give credit to everyone who was reviewing his set. Mm-hmm. Was done very classy. I think, and I'll call them out right now, I think Perry and Wendy are full of shit. I was listening to, Wendy gave a set at 8 out of 10, but she
7
was...
7 point something.
Something like that. And they were both...
Was she there?
Yeah. They were both there. And I was, and
I
it was like...
I didn't see Wendy.
Well, in all fairness, she said she really didn't listen to much of it.
But you can't give it an 8 out of 10. You can't give it an 8 out of 10. You gotta give it a 6. Because
so
you were
what did Beardo give it? He wasn't there.
Beardo wasn't there.
What did Cobster give it?
Cobster, what did you go give it? Just 4?
Like, rate his or the night overall?
His set.
His set?
Out of 10.
5.5.
Yeah, but that's like an honest. That's
he
an
just
honest
said
set.
He said it wasn't funny.
Yeah,
so that's
yeah,
why.
Yeah, it just wasn't funny.
But it had nothing to do with the performance. But they also spoke really highly of you, by the way. Everybody.
But, yeah. But, well, that was my point because I was misquoted yesterday on the show as well. I still hold to this, and I'll have the conversation with Ellis. I don't think Roka should have went up first with that crowd because the crowd was—they knew him, right? I don't think he was thrown to the wolves. That's where
no,
I was quoted.
For sure.
I don't think he was thrown to the wolves. I think that from what I've said, because you guys obviously know
dude,
what you're
the
doing.
The crowd was on fucking fire when he stepped on stage.
That's my point.
Yeah.
That's my point. Is the thing is, so you guys brought them to life, kicked ass. What I would have done, and it's Mark's show. I'm not saying he did it wrong. I'm just saying different managers have different lineups.
Sure.
What I would have done was had you guys do what you did, then I would have put a heavy hitter like Jay Washington or somebody too. Yeah. Because even if Roka, because like you said, he gets them fucking fired up, and then Roka comes in, it's going to be a little harder for him to follow it, but he's still got the crowd on his side.
Yeah.
Then he doesn't even, let's say it's just an okay set. Then people go, yeah, all right, who's next? But they're still riled up.
Right.
And it's not to say, look, it still seemed like it went off on a hitch. What the fuck do I know? I wasn't there.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying different managers do it.
It's a lot of
let me ask you, did you text Alice saying you didn't say that?
No.
Okay.
No. No, I didn't have it. No. I was going to bring it up with you guys first.
And now?
No. I
should I text him or?
No. My thing is, I don't believe he was thrown to the wolves. No. I just think he was.
I knew when I said it that I might have been misquoting.
Right.
You,
no, you did.
Which is why I was like, did he say that?
Never ask Riley because I've said to Riley. Riley, are we sure that this is it? Yes. And then he comes back, actually. Happens quite often.
Yeah, that's a good Riley invitation there.
But I've learned this about myself. And it's a little scary. I hear things that don't happen sometimes. My siblings always tell me this. They're like, that's not what we said.
According to my fiance, me too.
Yeah, and that's okay. And that's why I knew it. That's why it's like,
I'm so positive, and then I'm wrong.
Right.
Yeah. When you're wrong. You said something the other day that you were like, has that been the whole time? And I'm forgetting what it was. And it was
St. Louis?
Yeah. She thought that the town was called St. Louis, not St. Louis.
Oh. Because she's so enriched in sports that everyone says St. Louis.
He said St. Louis, and I started giggling, being like, this moron. And then I was like, wait a sec.
When was that?
Last week.
On this show?
No.
We were just walking around. Yeah. Okay.
But every time before we do our hypothetical question show, we go get lunch, and I say something dumb as shit, and it happened again.
I'm going to get you a St. Louis shirt.
Yeah.
I'm going to make you a St. Louis shirt.
I literally was like laughing at him, and then I was like, wait, let me just ask to clarify. And then.
How did you not know it was St. Louis?
I'm not sure.
Oh. I think she was going answer. With. I said I think she's answer. Going with like not. It's not Illinois.
Yeah,
it's Illinois. Yeah.
Meet me in St. Louis.
It's a song,
right? But
Louis Armstrong,
St. Louis Cardinals,
St. Louis.
But you're a baseball
go
fan.
Go Louis.
But you've watched baseball many times.
I know. I
St. Louis Cardinals.
Yeah, I don't know.
Didn't the Cardinals play the Red Sox?
Yeah.
Yeah. In a World Series.
Yeah.
Were you...
St. Louis.
Did you shut off?
I said it 5,000 times. St. Yeah. Louis. The St. Louis Cardinals.
I think people thought you were like, oh, she's real big into this St. Louis slang.
Right.
Nobody ever...
Correct her.
Nobody
people
ever,
do call it St. Louis.
Yeah. I've at least said it 5,000 times in my life over the course of the almost 3 decades I've lived.
Yeah.
And nobody's ever stopped me.
Well, because again, it's not necessarily wrong.
It's not wrong.
It's not wrong. People do say it, but because it's not... You weren't saying up top... Hey, stop calling it St. Louis because that's not what it is.
Yeah.
Because Missouri, the state of Missouri, is part of the Louisiana Purchase, right? Which was purchased from the French. So St. Louis was already a city
and
that existed.
Louis Bagata was the one who signed the deal.
Correct. Well, it was Louis Bagata.
You almost had it.
I was so close.
Damn, I was so ready.
You guys are the worst. When people say Oregon, I don't correct them.
But that's wrong.
That's
wrong. Right. But I don't say it's not. So when people have said St. Louis, I'm like, I'm not going to correct them.
Right. Yeah.
I've been doing this for the past year that I've been going here. I've been calling it Paso Robles.
Bless you.
And then somebody was saying, no, it's Robles.
Paso Robles.
What are you even talking about? Is that a restaurant?
No, it's a city in Central California.
It's a restaurant that serves great wine.
Owned by Louis Bagata.
And it's the entire 46 through California. Yeah.
Meet me in St. Louis.
It's wine country.
Yeah. All right. Well, good.
I'll give her a defense. You probably listened to a lot of Nelly back in the day, and every one of his rap songs he mentions St. Louis.
We're going down, baby.
Yeah. These fuckers.
Hope Street in a Range.
I love this stupid thing that they're doing. I got to be honest with you. All right.
I should have been that guy today.
Let's get out of St. Louis and let's move on over because there's something else that I wanted to bring. I don't know if you brought it up yesterday. If you did, good. So there used to be a Facebook page. Well, there still is a Schmoville Facebook page. But there is now a Collider Live Facebook page started by one of the admins of Schmoville, Rasika, who has the Collider Live page. And I don't know if we have the link, but maybe we can tweet out the link.
I go writing it sometimes.
The Schmoville one or
the Collider Live?
So there's a Collider Live one. So make sure you check that out. Join that because that's where they do kind of a lot of live chats and stuff too. So you can go to the Collider Live Facebook page.
They're cool homies.
Check it out, my friends.
They're from St. Louis.
Yeah,
that's where it's,
and
it's run out of.
Something else I was going to bring up, but I don't remember
what
it was.
I have questions for you. Oh.
Yeah, that was the question. The answer to your question, as I listened to the majority of the show, when I got here today, the Boba Fett conversation was on, and then I parked my car. The Frank stole my spot. Yeah.
He took your spot?
Only because they're going out of town today, so they were supposed to leave earlier. So
is that why he's not dressed like a pirate?
Probably.
Matey. St. Louis.
So what were your questions?
Unrelated to what we're talking about. Are you a person who likes giving out candy on Halloween? Does that happen in your community?
Do you get trick-or-treaters?
Yeah.
You know what? It really pisses my daughter off that we don't. Because it's just kind of the gated community that we have we don't. But
so do you take her trick-or-treating in your community?
We go to a certain neighborhood. We've been going for the last like 4 or 5 years. 4 years with her friends, and it's like this other neighborhood that would go, a whole group of us, and it's great.
Yeah. Oh, everybody goes, so all four of you will go together?
Well, this year it's going to be, because last year we couldn't go because my youngest was just born. She was only about a month old, but this year she's going, they're both Peter Pan and Tinkerbell.
Oh, nice. That's adorable.
So they'll be going today, and then my dad's coming into town to be with the kids.
So who stays at the house to give out the candy?
No, nobody. We're not going to be there. Right. For two reasons. One, no one comes to the house, and two, fuck you. I want to get my kids some candy.
Are you going to leave out a bowl or no?
No, because
if
I had that type of house, then yes, I would.
You would. Okay.
It's not a trick or treat kind of area.
Not the one that I'm
in. And your place.
Yeah, not the one that I'm in, because I feel the people's pain, because when you're walking by, you see the gate.
Yeah,
we're ready for it. We have a thing ready by the door, but nobody ever comes to the door.
Do you steal any of your kids' candy?
Yeah.
The only thing that I eat.
You don't have kids.
He
Josh.
Comes. No, he comes over and steals my kids.
Is that true?
No.
Shut it, Vivian. It's mine. Right.
Sleep in the hallway.
Sleep in the hallway. But I only thing that I'll eat is if they have Snickers. It's peanut butter. Peanut butter and chocolate is my
dude. Peanut M&M's is my.
Oh yeah, that's mine. It's the best.
I yell at my wife.
Well, you see that there's Reese's on the table out there.
I know, right? And I'm trying to stay away from it because it's Snickers though. They're really. I shouldn't be doing the Snickers, and then I have to have it with milk, and I fire it off.
So good.
Not a nuts girl.
Yeah,
I had
leaving it there.
My parents live on a cul-de-sac, mm-hmm. right? And when we were kids,
it's cold sack.
It's a cold sack.
It's a cold sack.
Cold sack. Yeah. When we were kids,
that's
they
not
made
true,
me get...
right?
Oh, fuck. That's true.
Yeah,
totally. Roxy crushing true. The improv.
Wait,
that's not right.
He's like crushing the AMAs.
No, the improv game.
Because the L is silent in cul-de-sac.
Yeah.
No, wait, I'm asking because I don't want another St. Louis situation.
It's C-U-L-D-E-S-A-C. It's a French word.
Cul-de-sac.
For turnaround. Yes.
I've been saying it right.
Yes.
Right.
Cul-de-sac.
Cul-de-sac.
Yeah. It's like
the cold sack.
Yeah.
I
feel pretty good about myself right now.
French for turnaround. That's good.
Yeah. Right.
Improv game strong.
So my parents used to get like 8 or 10 trick-or-treaters, but they don't get any anymore. But my dad still goes out and buys an absurd amount of candy. And my mom's like,
just in case they come back.
Through the last 3 years, they've had zero trick-or-treaters. 3 years straight, right? And my dad's like, hey, some kids just moved next door. I think they're going to trick-or-treat. I was like, how old are they? They're like, they're all in high school. I was like, you're not getting any trick-or-treaters.
So is that the truth? My brother and I were talking about this the other day. High school, no more trick-or-treating?
No, you're done at 12.
You're done at 12?
Yeah. Did you guys see... I don't know 13, what it was like.
Once you're a teenager, you cannot trick-or-treat.
Fuck me.
But you go out. What was it like in Boston? Because for...
The best.
Well, yeah. See, in New York, it was fucking scary at points. I'll tell you why. Once you got to a certain age, I think it was... I want to tell you around 9 or 10, right? It went from trick-or-treating to grab some eggs... Grab some shaving cream,
yes.
And
sure.
You're going to get into a fist fight.
For sure.
Like that was Halloween, and I hated it from like 10 on.
It was definitely the truth, and like booze came into play too.
Yeah, right.
At a pretty young age.
Right,
so,
okay. That doesn't happen. I don't see shaving cream and eggs anymore. I think they shut that shit down.
All of our cars, the houses, everything. Toilet paper.
Last night, October 30th, used to be Devil's Night, and we would sneak out.
No, we called it something else.
Did you?
Well,
so we call it Devil's Night. We toilet paper trees. What did you say, Beardo?
It's spelled like Samhain. Samhain.
Okay. No, what did you guys call it?
The night
Misfit,
before Halloween.
Misfits.
Now I call my anniversary.
Misfits Night or something.
Yeah. Okay. So my brothers and sister-in-law is November 1st. You guys all got married in like basically the same
area?
Weekend
yeah,
at the
yeah.
same time. But so Devil's Night was incredible. But did you guys ever get your Halloween candy stolen from like an older kid in your neighborhood or anything?
No,
like
but
that?
I've heard of it happening.
Yeah, I saw it. Never mind, though.
My brother just got his stolen, and I got mine stolen in the same night on different neighborhoods.
Right. Wait,
were you dressed as a tool?
They bully you and take it? Or?
No, they drove up in a car. They ran out with masks on, ripped all of our candy, and jumped back in the car.
That's terrifying.
That was terrifying. Yeah, it was.
I remember this crazy shit happened when we were kids too. Like people sticking razor blades in kids' shit and stuff too.
Candies and everything.
Yeah, because I remember this one house would give out like candied apples. Apples.
Yeah.
But we knew who they were, but I always was so terrified that there was going to be a razor blade, and I used to throw it in the trash.
There was a pot brownie house, I remember.
Really?
Yeah.
It's really nice.
Giving to kids. Yeah, it's fucked up, right?
That's crazy.
Yeah, they got pot.
See, we don't do that. That's the one thing. That's the rule, and this is because of my wife.
No baked goods?
No. Like, yeah. She won't let my daughter have anything until it's been inspected.
What about like school bake fair? School bake sale.
Yeah, sure. At school, I mean, absolutely.
There was always the one house that gave the big candy bars, and you were psyched about them.
Oh yeah.
Then there's
three.
Yeah. Oh yeah, the take three. Or I liked.
I get the 100.
No, take five is the one.
No. I'm saying take three pieces.
Oh, take
like people that write like how many you could take instead of take one or take two, take three. Yeah.
Right. We took the bowl.
Yeah. Well, so that's what's happening today. I'm gonna go do the Halloween.
And you like it?
I do like it.
I just can't picture you.
Being Halloween with kids.
Yeah,
They wanted me to dress up as Captain Hook, and I considered it.
I think you should.
Like at this point, I can't.
Well,
it's to dress up as Rogue.
Why don't you just go dressed as the Predator?
As the Predator. Yeah, sure.
So, do you not dress up at all?
No, sometimes I do. But I mean, before I was married, Halloween was my thing that I would. You couldn't drag me away from Halloween parties because that was the best place to try to not be single anymore. Yeah, at least that time.
The last party I had, and you remember my parties.
Go ahead and tell the story. I have something about that party.
We had the craziest Halloween parties when I lived in this duplex, like down the street from him. And the last party, I remember walking in and looking at, and my place was huge, wood floors, high ceilings, duplex. I didn't recognize a single person. There must have been hundreds of people there that just were walking on the street, and this is right around an area that the Grove,
heavy foot traffic.
And Christian was in a kissing booth, right? And you
contest.
That was your costume.
The girl I was dating at the time made it for me.
Whoa!
And
what an idiot.
Yeah. Well, no, she. It wasn't. It wasn't exclusive. So it was a kissing booth.
Still
contest.
Kind of an idiot.
She said, go have fun.
This is my favorite thing.
I like that girl.
End of the night, we were so wasted. You were kicking that thing down the street.
I was.
Do you remember that?
I jumped on it, and
fuck it.
I do remember that. I beat the piss out of it. But that was the year before this one. I'm trying to – I don't know if we can find it in time, but on – I think it's on the SK Plus channel. There's a – so I was there, and I was talking to this – one girl, and she was really this one girl was really attractive, right? Mm-hmm. So, and she's a friend. Remember Beets, Riley?
Yeah,
by Dre. Oh,
yeah, I remember. Beets.
No. We call it the vegetable. Our friend Beets. Yeah, it's like it's not Halloween. It's phone call. Put Schmo's archive phone call. Let's see. Shoot, you'd have to go like to the oldest ones, but I really want to put.
What are we trying to pull up?
It's a phone. So I'll tell you what happened. So. This girl who was, again, an attractive girl, she was
when you were dating?
No. This was a girl she was interested in, and I was like, okay, you know, and I went there, went to this party, but she got really hammered. She became less attractive. She's a very attractive girl, but became less attractive because of how, like, slurring and things she was saying. And
sloppy.
That's not it. Wrong number, Dana. But go to oldest videos first inside of the Schmoes Archive.
The tape?
No, that's not it. The Schmoes Archive. Just the actual thing. You go to oldest to newest, and see if it's, and I'll see if it's in there. So anyway, so I leave the place. I went up going home with this other girl that I met that night, right? And as
what was she dressed as? I'm just trying to paint a picture.
I want to tell you a fairy. Go back up. Sorry.
Damn it.
I'm trying to look where it is. It might
good
be
correction.
It might be on the actual podcast channel itself. Keep going down. No, go to the podcast
that's
channel.
That's what she said. That's what he said.
That's right. Go to the podcast. Either one of them could have said it. Go to the podcast
channel. That's true.
So thanks, guys. I wind up leaving, and I get a phone call in the morning from the other girl, and it is the
– Sloppy girl?
Yes, and it is the best phone call. I put it online, and it's just basically her hammered –
You recorded it?
Yeah, hammered out of her mind. And oldest to newest? Is that oldest to newest? Yeah, I got to find – that's the oldest to newest? Shit!
Yes,
all the way up, all the way up. It's got to be on the other one. I'll look for it. I'll look for it. And I'll play it tomorrow, or on Monday. So she and
look
she,
right at break.
I will. And she does. And she just left this whole long thing of look, you son of a bitch. You want to go home with a bad costume? Well, if you want to do it, do it. If you got the balls, drop them. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. This is it.
You were looking at this. Okay, here we go.
Oh, sorry.
I'm so excited.
Listen.
Don't be
Wow.
That's what I got. That's what I got in the morning.
Don't be scared.
And the girl that I was with, I said, you got to listen to this.
I think that was the F-bomb she dropped. I don't think that was a bad costume.
What do you think she said?
I think she said the F-bomb costume.
I don't know. Whatever it was.
She was on one.
I love the don't be scared. Don't be scared.
My wife and I to this day still say, don't be scared, don't be scared. It's the best. It was the best.
Wow. I am so embarrassed to say that sounded so similar to me.
You would do that?
Fucking scary.
Really?
I still have nightmares about people I used to flirt with. Oh. Like legitimate nightmares. Because when you don't give a fuck, you say the dumbest shit. And like, I remember just being on so many drugs and so fucked up. I mean,
St. Louis, Louis Vuitton.
Stoned?
Cold sack?
No, I took all the drugs back in the day.
All the drugs, all the records.
All the belts, all the records, yeah. I think I've talked about this about 1,000 times. I took a bunch of acid. I took tons of ecstasy. But at the time, for like 3 years, I took tons of Xanax all the time and drank so much. So I was like blacked out for 3 years of my life.
Shit, okay. So you're going to make some don't be scared phone calls in that time.
Yeah, of course. And like when you come out of your blacked out stupor, and again, like I'm a big advocate of you have to do what you have to do to wake up in the morning. And at the time, that's what I fucking had to do to wake up in the morning. And so I'm not embarrassed of it, which is why I talk about it. But I made some, like I would take the shyest boy in school. It, like, that was cute, but so, so shy. And I would send him, like, the filthiest messages. Just, like, you know you want it. Like, I remember I was hooking up with a really shy guy one time, and I stopped, and I looked at him, and I said, compliment my boobs. And he said, and he looked up at me. I have never seen somebody more afraid.
How old are you at this point?
I must have been, like, 17.
Okay, and tell him to compliment.
Compliment my boobs. Yeah. And he was like, I like your boobs. They're nice. I was like, that's not fucking enough. Say I have the best
totally
boobs
you've ever.
Yeah, it was like, ugh.
Right. It's like just domination like, stuff.
Yeah, and I only remember that because he ended up being my friend and tells me the story, and I'm like, oh, it's so gross.
Right.
He was like, I didn't know what to do. He was shouting at me to compliment your boobs.
I can picture it, though. Yeah.
In a parallel universe, Josh Macuga, like probably 10 years before Roxy, in college, my friends tell stories about the voicemails that they've heard that girls have played them of me and being like, why did you leave? Yes, it totally did.
Oh, God. So many of them are out there of me.
Brutal, but hysterical.
Why did you think you took the honor? Yeah. What?
Yeah.
You did?
Remember answering machines? Yeah. I was on some dorm answering machines of girls. I was like, Candace!
Hey!
Candace! Answer, please. I'm downstairs. And
nothing. No. Well, good.
Would we have been friends or we hated each other?
No, we would have been great friends.
Well, Riley, that's why Riley knew. Riley got the fuck out of here. He's done some drunk stuff too. But anyway, that was a bunch of fun stories. Go memory lane.
Halloween rocks. You got to get laid.
It was the most fun.
He's got to leave
the
dick.
It's the sexiest of sex holidays.
No, you don't leave the dick. You stay on the dick on Halloween.
Oh.
I was just correcting that.
That's
the bitch who was speaking.
Oh,
I'm so fucked. On Halloween.
Otherwise, why do you do it?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's true. Well, that was why I don't definitely go to Halloween parties and everything with having also two kids.
But East Coast is different than West Coast because, I mean, your college Halloweens, it was warm weather. Everybody in Pennsylvania, it is, you know, 30 degrees. It's so cold. Yeah. But I remember I would dress as the Three Amigos. I lost my other two Amigos midway through the night. I slept over at a girl's place. I couldn't find any of my costume but my pants and the sombrero. And her apartment was a solid like half mile from my place. And this is before Ubers and taxis.
So at that point, do you wear the sombrero with the pants or no sombrero?
I just carried the sombrero, pants, and shoes, and walked home shirtless at like 9:30 a.m. as kids
freezing
are going to class,
balls off.
Freezing.
Yeah.
Walking in, everybody's like, well, that makes sense.
I remember that back in the day. It's really hard to look sexy and slutty in cold weather.
What's the worst message that you left, though? Do you remember it or you don't remember?
I don't remember. I literally have 3 years of my life.
Look at my boobs!
Almost nothing.
All right.
Almost nothing there.
That's fair.
But when people tell me things, I'm like,
makes sense.
Makes sense. Yeah.
Right.
You can't be that person who's like, I didn't do that. If you don't fucking remember, you did whatever the fuck they said you did.
It's true. Totally true. I had a couple of those in college for sure to where I was. I went through a little. I was with a girl. We broke up, and then it went through hammered and pissed off because it didn't want to be broken up type thing. And people were like, no, that's what you did last night.
Yeah.
And I'm like, probably true.
Yeah. It's so annoying. Cool. The guy that's like, I didn't fucking do that. It's then tell me what did happen. Yeah.
I can't speak on that. But then that's why I didn't do that. That was like, you said it was like 3 years. I think I went through like 2 or 3 months. And then that was it. And it's also 20 years old, whatever it was.
If you wake up with scrapes, bruises, like branches, you know, whatever on your body,
yeah,
people tell you what happened and they were there, then you have to believe
that. That's what you did.
You
that's
have
what you
to.
Did.
Right. Yeah. It's,
there's no other real
and just fucking apologize. I fucking fought my best friend.
Robin Williams had the best joke about it. He's like, that's why he stopped drinking. He's like, because people will tell you. He's like, what? I shit in your tuba. It's like people think you have to work the next day. You got to hear about all the stuff that you did.
And I don't want to.
No one wants to hear about it. Yeah. All right. Well, when we get back, there's a couple things we're going to talk about here. I messed around with the idea of actually watching the thing last night. I almost did it. I'll talk to you guys about that in a little bit. But we also got into a little bit of debate with Thad and Roka before the show started about the sequels that are coming out, which one is going to be the least received? Now, that also means box office. Does it mean critically with fans? We're going to talk about that. Is it Wreck-It Ralph? Is it the Dragon Tattoo one? Is it Creed? Or is it Fantastic Beasts? We'll talk about that after the break. And then at 11:30, Matthew Lillard in studio. Clarity Lab.
He's still working on his sportsmanship.
There. No, it's not late to the party. That's actually from Obi-Wan Kenobi. You didn't know that? Well, you should, and now you do. Jedi Council. What is it? It's about Star Wars, obviously. It's Jedi Council. Every week, the latest and greatest in Star Wars movie news, myself and Ken Napsok, that's right, the pit boss himself, we have a guest on and we talk about everything happening in the world of Star Wars. If it's the movie news, the TV news, canon news, comic books, games, and then we take questions from you guys on Facebook and Twitter. It's a lot of fun. We've been doing it for a couple of years now. I'm still excited talking about it. The fan base is coming together again. I believe it is. I think it is. I hope it is. And we're talking Star Wars, so we'd like you. That's right, all of you. If you're not a fan of Star Wars, come on over and join us every Thursday for Collider Jedi Council here on Collider Video. And we have an Apple Podcast feed or Podcast One, wherever you want to go if you listen to podcasts. And not only do you get Collider Jedi Council every week on Thursday, The Rule of Two with Mark Fernandez and Mark Riley, that's on every week. I believe it drops on Wednesday. It's on one of these days. It's a good show. You should listen to it. I like it. I listen to it. I haven't listened to it once.
Hey everyone, Mark Ellis here. You know, when I'm not trying to clone dinosaurs or drinking in my neighborhood watering hole, I am probably hosting Collider Movie Talk. It's a flagship show here at Collider. I like to say that because I'm the host of it. It's every day, almost. It's 4 days a week, which is still pretty good, above 50%. You can watch it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. 4 p.m. Los Angeles time is when we do it. It's live, so you can participate in the live chat room. Go ahead and give us your thoughts on every story we have coming because it's all the latest movie news of the day. Who did what at the box office? What horrible Redbox movies Bruce Willis signed on to? The DC, the Marvel, the Star Warses, the Lord of the Rings. Are they making new? I think it's a TV show, and we still might talk about it anyway because we love movies around here. It's myself and an expert panel of guests, including John Roka, Perry Nemiroff, Jeff Snyder, and other noted noters of note. You guys are going to love this show, and we take your live Twitter questions at the end of the show at Collider Video. You can always use the hashtag Collider Movie Talk to get in touch with us, so subscribe right here to Collider Video. Check out Movie Talk, and check out the Collider Movie Talk podcast feed. We have a podcast feed now. You don't have to look at this handsomeness. You can just listen to it, whether you're driving to work, whether you're driving from work, or you don't have a job, but you have a basement and ears. You can listen to Collider Movie Talks feed. You can get it at Apple Podcasts or on iTunes. You also get Mailbag. That's the show that's hosted by Perry Nemiroff a lot more professionally than I run this pirate ship. That's our weekend show where she takes your letters. I don't know if you write them or you email them. You have to ask her. And Afterthoughts, hosted by Ryan Snelling and Jay Williams. I almost said Ryan Williams and Jay Snelling. Would anybody have known the difference? I certainly would. I would have felt bad about it. Because I'm a nice person, and that's why I host Collider Movie Talk. Check it out in video form or on our podcast feed.
Hi there. I see that you're enjoying Collider Live. After this show, why not check out Collider Games, where we play, well, games. We review games. We talk about things, anything that's going on in the gaming world, our opinions, news, all kinds of stuff. So check it out. If you like it, stick around and subscribe.
Hey, everyone. John Rocha here, one of the hosts for Collider Sports Time. That's our new show there on the Collider Sports Network. It's our flagship show, just like Collider Movie Talk. We get on, talk about a bunch of sports issues of the day and what is burning up social media, what topics are burning up social media. That's what we do on Collider Sports Time. I'm joined by my top 10 co-host, Matt Nost. Me and him, we welcome a bevy of guests every week to talk about NFL, the Major League Baseball playoffs, NHL, and the NBA, which is starting up soon. We're going to talk about that. We also get into UFC stuff, college football, all the stuff that's happening in the world of sports. We're going to cover it on Collider Sports Time. And we're going to take the time to break it all down and give our opinions and our unique takes and unfiltered thoughts on what we think about the sports news of the day. So don't forget to join us every week on Monday for the Collider Sports Time show on the Collider Sports Network. And don't forget to subscribe on the Collider Sports Network on YouTube and on the Collider Sports podcast feed. We're going to bring you all kinds of stuff. Hope to hear from you soon.
Hey, everyone. I'm Scott Movie Mantz. And just to let you know, if you already don't, every Friday here on Collider Video, I host a weekly film review series called Movie Review Talk. The title says it all. Every week, I'm joined by two guest critics of my choice, and they're never the same. We review the new films. We pick something that's streaming that you might not know about, but is really great. And we pick a Blu-ray for something that you might have missed in theaters. It is fun. It is infectious. It is the Citizen Kane of movie review shows, and it's only right here on Collider with this guy, Scott Movie Mantz, Mr. Movie Release Dates himself. Check it out every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific, only on Collider Video.
We're back. It's Collider Live. It's Wednesday. It's the last show of the week. And I'm here once again with Josh Macuga and Mark Riley and Charlotte Flair and the rest of the crew. And Roxy Stryer, of course. And we are... We are Charlotte Flair. Charlotte Flair.
Yeah. Charlotte.
All right. And we are back from break. And a couple things before we get into our next topic here. I wanted to mention to you guys, I know yesterday, and I appreciate everybody talking about the brand new Schmoedown website that is launching tomorrow. I know that I thought yesterday was Halloween for some reason. And it's November 1st is when it goes live. And I know that some people are trying to sign up because the name of the site is triviasd.com. TriviaSD.com, and you'll be able to sign up. Over 2,000 people already signed up, and we're sending out emails, and we need more and more and more people to do that. It's going to be a lot of cool ways, new hub, new ways to get schedule, news. We have people that are writing it.
Are you the editor-in-chief?
No, I haven't announced who the – it'll be managing editor. Riley's looking over the entire thing, right? But I have a managing editor.
Overlord.
And I have someone already in place.
When are you going to announce it?
Very soon. I just confirmed with this person that they're going to do it, and they will be in charge of it.
Do we know them?
You do.
Is it a boy or a girl?
I did not want to say that yet.
How tall are they?
I don't want to give any information out.
3 foot.
Does
nine.
Their name start with a smell? Q?
No. But what I will do is they will be running the whole entire thing, and the only person that they will be having to check in with is Riley for information as far as how it runs. But they will be managing all of the writers. They will be making sure, you know, coordinating with me on content. This person that we have is great. Very experienced.
Is it Beardo and that's the job he got?
No, very experienced, but knows the show very well. Knows.
Is it Fred Durst?
It is not. Mm. Although he was yeah. he was third on the list.
Have I slept with him?
No, I don't think so.
Oh.
I don't think so.
Or her.
Or her.
Yeah, slept with them. I only slept with one woman.
Is
this
the website
like
where we can finally get the poll up for the Wildberries hosted Wildberries? Fatal five-way of only Wildberries categories?
There will be tons of options.
We can make that happen.
There can be polls, for
sure. We should definitely make that happen.
And it reminds me of Drunk Dewberry.
Yeah.
Because Macuga and I talk about it all the time. Have you ever seen Drunk Dewberry?
Oh, it's incredible.
I don't think so.
It's the greatest thing that you will ever see. Yeah. He does,
I want to be his friend. I don't know how to do it, though.
Just talk to him. He's the best. He won't remember. But
he's the nicest guy in the world.
He's the nicest guy in the world.
He's nice.
Yeah. And so at the live events, it's always this, hi. So, and I had to think, and it was, and I'm like, But I'm like, you guys really crush it. Yeah, I know. I'm a cool guy. And we up there. And I was, ow! And they were like, I mean, I love it.
Oh, how do we find him? From
how,
Josh?
How do we find him? Yeah. No, Machinima. Well, the funny thing is I knew Elliot and Ricky, but I knew Elliot first from Machinima when Mark and I had our own show there, and Elliot had not even been on camera yet. He was like our camera guy.
I've been saying that one wrong, too. I thought it was Machinima.
Some people, yeah, I think it is Machinima. I think you actually said it right. So he was our camera guy.
Same
and
way.
Then when we started doing our weekly show, Ricky was our producer, and they had never been on camera before. And then they did, and they blew up. And Ricky and Elliot had their own show. They're brilliant together.
Yeah, two
of them. Ricky and Elliot together are like two of the funniest guys.
I've done their show a couple times.
What is
it's
that? What is it?
It's just a news show.
Yeah, it's a new show that they brought.
They just talk about pop culture topics
or
politics or whatever. It's awesome.
I love Ricky and Elliot.
Yeah,
I think they are two of the most stand-up dudes, and they are funny as hell. They're good people, and I support everything that they fucking do.
Yeah. When it comes awesome.
To, yeah, they're great. But 100%. Anyway, but Drunk Dewberry is my favorite.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah, you tell me where I gotta be.
So why is Elliot's teammate not Ricky?
It was. And they broke up.
All right.
Yeah, they broke up. And then
mostly because Ricky is terrible at trivia. Hell of a guy.
He might be
hell
the of a worst. Manager. Ranking in Schmoedown competitors, he might be the worst of all time.
I played a team match with him, and I don't think he got one question right Dewberry in the
had
first
to do the whole thing,
round.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Dewberry carried. So that's why you got a little Macuga in there?
It was great.
Well, anyway, so the website will be live tomorrow, triviasd.com. Keep checking to see if you can sign up. We're just doing a couple of improvements right now and cleanup. That's why you can't access it, but it'll be up and ready tomorrow, and I think we'll be able to announce who the managing editor is today.
Okay.
All right.
Also,
now,
let
me transition.
Oh, I thought you were sorry. I'm sorry.
And now the other thing that we have going on today is Josh Macuga is doing something very special. Go ahead and let us know.
Well, at 2:30. At 2:30 p.m. PST, myself, you, as we usually do, we're going to do the final chapter of the Exorcist VR, Chapter 5.
Yes,
we're going to do it live on Twitch. So go to twitch.com/collider. And you can tune in live to watch Kristian walk me through the final chapter.
Don't miss this.
You can go up now and watch chapters 1 through 4. Chapters 3 and 4, the guy that created the game. He bought the licensing. He developed it. They're from Fun Train. They did it with a company out of England. He walked me through chapters 3 and 4. I screamed. His name was Doug. And it's an easy name to scream when things are going wrong. I was
one
like,
syllable.
Doug! Doug! Chapter 3 was absolutely petrifyingly scary.
Yeah.
I almost took out the goggles like 3 or 4 times. Then the fourth one, he tricked me. He's like, it's during daylight. It's not as scary. It's during daylight. Well, yeah, the first 2 seconds is during daylight. Then you have to go underground while zombie bodies
but he wasn't
in
lying.
80.
It was still technically during daylight.
Correct.
You just weren't
in
daylight.
It was a caveat.
So he wasn't lying to you.
And this is the final chapter. I hear it's a doozy.
Okay, so
it's
good.
So 2:30 p.m. PST.
I thought you were going to plug the show that we do, but you didn't.
No. Well, we also do that today, which is Hypothetical Questions with Roxy and Josh. And we ask one hypothetical question about television that leads into a million other hypothetical questions.
Which I like. And I guess
yeah.
Well, all right. Well, make sure you do that on Twitch because, and I'm glad, I'm happy that I could make that because I originally wasn't able to, but we pushed it back an hour.
Yeah. Well, Macuga at lunch told me that he doesn't ever want to do them without you because he says that you straight up are the most supportive person. You actually understand
it's
how afraid he is.
It's my safe place as long as Christian's there.
He doesn't feel okay doing it without you. That was a legitimate conversation we had.
Well, what it is because he knows I'm there to have fun with him, and because if I can crack some jokes while he's there, it takes him out of the just being scared out of his mind.
And you're supportive.
Because
you know how real it is.
And I make him throw things. I love when he throws things. I love when you throw things. And it's like our thing that we do when he's playing. It's just like I'm like you're feeling stressed out. Just take that thing and throw it.
And throw it. Just pick it up.
I don't know what it is about VR. It is so fun to throw things.
It
in
really
VR.
Is. It really is.
It's
fun.
It's so much fun to just throw things. So we had that one game that we were playing with that creepy bear. Remember that creepy bear?
Yeah.
We were just throwing things in the kitchen and at the mom, like everything. It was great.
Stop that.
Don't worry. You're going to have enough of Macuga screaming.
Oh,
so make sure. Yeah, join us over at Twitch TV.
Twitch.com.
Twitch.tv/Collider.
Yeah.
And one more plug.
Yes.
Can you guys check out the final part of the Top 10 Horror Series?
Yes.
Thing that I've been working on that no one around here watched. So check it out. It's up there right now. 5 through 1.
I would have watched it.
I'll tell you what, Cops.
I watched it.
That's above my pay grade.
I was not invited.
I would have had
you guys
you
said
there.
I'm always invited. I was uninvited.
I would have had
you. Were
you
a horror fan?
I will say the vitriol that was in the Twitter and the Instagrams and the comments
about
that,
a top 10 list.
The fact that we didn't put in your new favorite movie, The Thing. The Thing was an honorable mention.
Yeah.
It was.
Well, JT tweeted out about it too.
So people attacked me about it, and I was like, I'm not even in this.
I know. Well, I'll tell you.
Sorry, cops.
So you did do it.
It's so.
They scared me.
No, you did it.
It was my fault?
Yeah.
Sure. Well, Macuga came in this morning and he's like, I liked what you did with your Instagram post yesterday. Yeah.
I didn't get it.
You didn't understand what I did?
Yeah.
So I just...
To be honest.
I knew that we were going to be talking about the thing at one point today. So my idea was, you know what? What if I go in and I watch the thing tonight and I'll watch it? So I'm like, let me just look what the runtime is. And in my
head... And that was too long for you? Is that what you're saying?
No. No. Not really.
Oh.
It's just a matter that... It could have said half an hour. I still wouldn't have watched it.
You were making a yoke.
I was going to watch it. I was going to watch it, and then I said, nah.
I'm convinced now you're never going to watch this.
I probably won't. And it has nothing
We're going to play it at your funeral. 50 years from now, playing it at your funeral.
I was watching it. Look, the way I'm eating, it'll probably be five. I was watching. I was really going to do it, but then I was like, my wife's not going to watch this. I'm like, who am I bullshitting?
Yeah.
Like, she's going to come out here. It's our anniversary. Am I going to try to pitch the thing?
Wow, you were going to try to anniversary it?
Well, I was going to try, but I didn't even bring it up.
What's worse, a Fitbit or watching the thing?
Well, I mean, it's not better what we did watch. Watch The Fucking Voice last night. Yeah. So it's like,
that's so much more anniversary.
Is it better?
I guess it is.
I guess you're right, because there's some romantic songs
it's
playing
cute and
stuff.
It's sweet.
But did she want to watch like a Halloween movie tonight?
She wanted to watch Halloween, and I actually did say, how about The Thing? To which she replied, no, I want to watch Halloween. I said, fine.
Yeah. Has she seen The Thing?
I can't argue with that.
Maybe years ago. I don't know. She's not, but it's not her. Not her thing.
Not her bag.
Dang. Anyway, I posted it up and people went nuts, and I knew exactly what was going to happen when I posted it. It was like, you think that's too long? It's like, no, it's actually a good runtime. Yeah. It's a really good runtime. But you know, like you said, sometimes just you poke.
Ding,
you poke.
Ding, I get it now.
Yeah. So that's kind of that was the reasoning for the post. But will I ever watch The Thing? I don't know. I don't know the answer to this question.
I know the answer to this question.
You think it'll never be no?
I think you never now.
I want to tell you though, it's not because I don't want to see it. I like Kurt Russell. I like John Carpenter. I've never seen a trailer or heard someone talk about it and say that doesn't sound like anything I want to watch. It actually sounds like something I probably would really enjoy.
Wilford Brimley.
Is it your number one movie you haven't seen?
Come on. Number
that's
one.
That's the sales. Wilford Brimley.
Wilford Brimley. Pepperidge Farm remembers.
And don't be scared. I thought you guys gonna play Don't Be Scared. The Thing. We've never reviewed it before. What are you looking for?
You saw the prequel, but you haven't seen the goddamn original?
I did not see. That was
it just Mark?
It was just
Mark. We'll find out. Oh, yeah, you're right.
Can you answer my question?
Yeah. Sorry. Which was?
Is it the number one?
No. There are movies that I haven't seen, classics that I probably... there's other big ones that, I mean, again, Lawrence of Arabia, I don't really remember that well. I know I saw it very, very long.
Slow, long movie.
And it's a classic, and I want to see it. Citizen Kane, I've seen it before, but I don't really remember it that much.
It's fine.
What did I see something the other day? Oh, no, Halloween. Halloween I've seen, right? And I watched the trailer again the other day, and I said to Riley, I said, I don't remember a fucking thing about this movie.
Right.
I remember the beginning of it. I remember the beginning when they take the mask off of Michael. I've seen Halloween. I know I've seen. I've seen it, but I don't like. I looked at all the trailers. I'm like, I remember none of this. So, and that one I'm actually looking forward to seeing. But as far as The Thing goes, I like John Carpenter.
You just did an Elliot there. Hi, John Carpenter.
Hi, God. He's for the
Carpenter.
He's a fuck in the thing.
He's in the snow.
But. Maybe I'll see it, maybe I won't. Rox, what do you think? You think I'll ever see this fucking thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I just think at some point you'll be sitting there like, fuck it.
And just do it.
Yeah.
And I have it. JT bought it for me.
You have it.
He got it for me for my birthday 2 years ago.
Did he really?
Let me just take that off your hands. I want it. It's a Blu-ray, isn't it?
No.
Okay.
But anyway.
JT got you
a really
non-Blu-ray?
Use the Blu-ray.
He got me a Blu-ray.
Oh, it is a Blu-ray.
Blu-ray.
Oh, no
to... Yeah.
No to him taking.
Mm-hmm. No to him taking. He can't have anything. And so that's it. So that's where we land with that. Congratulations to everybody who responded to the Instagram post. I salute you. We are going to now move on. I was here this morning and I walked in and I walked into a conversation between Perry, Thad, and Roka. And I don't think Roka's available. I think he's, you know, scratching his ball bag on Heroes, whatever he's doing. And he's
still working on his spoonsmanship.
Thank you. That's correct. What he's doing.
That's a good one.
So he is he's not available. I don't know if Thad's in the booth with the boys, but if he is able to,
let me go find him,
please.
I'm go search for
yeah,
him
just
right
put
now.
Him put him in the booth.
By the way, Thad may be my favorite person at Collider. I like you guys all a lot.
I appreciate
too.
That. Yeah. I understand.
Thad's one of the
so
best.
Legit.
He's no bullshit.
Yeah.
He is one of the hardest workers you will ever meet.
Yeah.
He's here at 4 a.m.
Yeah,
working on shit, and yeah. then
I'm so down with that.
He's the best.
Yeah.
He's the best.
And you got. I mean, I don't want to like toot my own horn, but I'm going to toot it.
You found him.
I brought
yeah.
him here.
Yeah,
yeah,
he
did.
Because he was working on the, at the time between the sheets.
Yeah. Yeah. And he was been my friend for a long time, and the dude is just a stud when it comes to figuring out how to put things on camera and make them look good.
Yeah.
He's great.
He's a fucking
great.
Stud.
He yep. really is.
Well, anyway.
Well, I walked into the conversation they were having, and this was the debate that was on the table, and I think I want to open this up to everybody.
Yes.
Is Thad in the room yet?
I don't know where they're at. No.
Right,
they might be in a meeting. They're very important around here.
All right, fine. We can have the conversation with Adam. If we happen to find him, I'd like to get his opinion on it.
Who's the other person?
What
Perry?
About Perry? Is Perry in there?
Negative. No. She's scared.
Perry's
I'm just kidding.
Scared?
I don't know where she's at. I can't find her.
She's not at her desk either?
Nah.
Don't be scared.
Fine. Are you lying to me, Constance?
I'm not lying. Right, why would I lie? You want right. to open the door.
Oh, I thought I'd get more laughs with that.
I didn't hear what you said.
Don't be scared.
Don't
be scared.
Scared.
Don't be scared.
Thank you.
I like it. Thank you.
Thank
Peter.
You, guys. Shamarone! Always funnier when you have to repeat it.
Yeah, it's always better. Shamarone. That wasn't a Shamarone.
That wasn't totally not a Shamarone.
Thank you.
Yeah. And Shamarone isn't a diss at Ellis, by the way.
No, it's not.
No, at all. It's a character that he did.
I still can't figure out how to diss him, though. I was looking at him all day.
Well, the funny thing is, Roker brought up the bug eyes, whatever the two.
Yeah.
He, you know, how many times people bring up a picture of Peter Lorre. You know, how similar Ellis looks to Peter Lorre.
I can't picture
Peter
that.
Peter Lorre,
the great old school actor from Casablanca and
L O
R. Oh wait, I know
who
it is.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
kind of.
Keep moving. Can you move to the next picture?
That does look like black and white Mark Ellis.
Yeah,
I feel like I have his.
Just keep going back to the old pictures. That's not that. Go back to Google Images. Come on, guys, stop fucking around.
This computer is awful. Sorry.
All right, fine. Yeah. There you go.
That's Ellis.
That's Ellis.
Right there.
Wow.
Yeah. Right. It looks like Ellis.
But that's not making fun of him.
Not at all.
Yeah.
Not at all. It's just like, but Peter Lorre is known for like the googly eyes as well too. But
the googly eyes.
What he said though yesterday, and he didn't, and no one could bring it up because no one knew the reference he was making. But then, when Riley asked him, he's like, "Why do you say you look like what?" He's like, "I look like a puppet, right?"
Yeah.
Dice said that on Rogan's show, on Joe Rogan's show.
Dice said about Ellis.
And he goes, "It looks like a puppet," because he was mad. He was mad. Dice was mad at Ellis for some silly thing about it. I don't know. Is that? I don't remember what happened.
That's
but he was
amazing.
Saying, it looks like a puppet. I want to pull that audio. I want to get that audio. So I mean, I don't know if Beardos can do it on his last.
Can you give me some dirt?
Hurrah.
Like, what do I do?
On him?
Yeah.
I don't know.
We make fun of him for everything
for
anyway.
What?
And he just
for
he shrugs
he
it
just
off.
Rolls off his.
He's good.
That's
he,
why. I
why
can't...
you want to get under his skin?
I just want one thing.
There's... To get under his skin about? I mean,
I don't think
know.
He can.
Yeah, I mean, there are times you got to catch him at the right moment. Like, the funniest thing ever was, and I won't bring up the whole story why, because it'll bring it back, and then he definitely will get pissed off. But something happened back in the day when we first started. You remember this?
Oh yeah.
When we first started the show, and there was something that was going on, and the fans were taking to it, and Ellis was done with it.
Yeah.
So Ellis came.
But you're not going to tell me what it was?
I'll tell you off here. I made him a promise that
okay.
I would
never
talk about it.
Yeah.
And so we got back to my place to shoot a review, and he came in steaming. Steaming. And so he's like, I just ran in to a 16-year-old kid who said this. Yeah. And he's screaming it. And to hear him yell, you don't hear.
It only happened one time, and I was coated with the hot sauce.
Let me see your
pen.
Yeah.
Because I want to write down what you got your wife and what you call what this thing with Alice is.
Okay. So, and he's screaming it, and I'm crying and listening to it, and then I just start crying laughing because I watch him screaming, and what is coming out of his mouth was amazing. And then he realizes how ridiculous he's sounding while he's screaming this thing, and he starts crying laughing, but he's still screaming. It was one of the moments that I wish we had on tape. It is. I remember.
And like fans were calling him.
It started as a nickname on the show.
It was something. It was something that along the lines that happened. But again, I'll talk to you about it. But anyway, we completely digressed.
Yeah.
I walked into this conversation between Thad and Perry, and they're talking about these sequels that are coming out. You got Wreck-It Ralph 2.
Mm-hmm.
You got Creed 2. Fantastic Beasts, and then the girl with the tattoo upside her head. What's it called?
Girl. Spider's Web.
Spider's Web is the new one. Now, the
you
question.
Go on to that?
No, it's today, like 3 o'clock.
No, there's one on. There's also one on Sunday.
Is there one on Sunday also? Yeah. Probably not. I'm gonna have to. I do want to see it. I actually really liked the first one, the remake, the American version, with Daniel Craig. I liked it. I do want to see it because I also like the director. But I think that this is the movie, and I think that the studio is very well aware of this. This will be the one that does the worst out of the four.
Yes.
Now, critically, I don't know if that's true. But box office wise, I believe it's true. We're all on the same page. At box office, we think out of the four of these will be
100%.
All right. Well, let's switch to critically because what's on the table here, the big one that on the table was they think Creed 2. Thad and Perry believe that Creed 2 will be a disappointment critically with fans and critics.
So is this the biggest critical drop from the original or the worst Rotten Tomatoes score of the bunch?
I mean, we can make our own rules right now. That was never really brought up, but I think that it's a matter of not out of the bunch. I think just for Rotten Tomatoes score for out of those four.
Out of the four, yeah.
Correct. Not out of the series themselves, but
I 100% disagree.
Okay, what do you got?
100% disagree. One, I don't care about the girl in the dragon tattoo, the spider webs, walking into spider webs, no doubt, whatever. I don't care about that movie. I thought the girl with the dragon tattoo, walking into spider webs.
Yeah. I'm walking in the spider webs. Sing it.
You had it. I thought the first movie was incredibly long and boring. Okay. It wasn't for me. So I think that's going to get like an okay critical review. Okay. Claire Foy with those eyeballs is, and that's going to be another eyeball heavy movie.
At least she's got a British accent in it.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah. You think critically be the lowest?
No, I don't think critically, but by far the thing. But I think critically the lowest one, it may be. Maybe Wreck-It Ralph too.
Nah,
you don't think?
I think that Spiderweb critically and financially lowest because definitely not going to be Wreck-It Ralph 2. The one that it could be if it bites the dick is Fantastic Beasts, but I don't think Fantastic Beasts is going to get panned. So I think it's going to be Spiderweb.
I think Fantastic Beasts will get panned as well.
Critically, here's the thing though. There's different critically. I think with the Rotten Tomatoes score, I'm actually going to go with these two and say Creed. However, I think
really,
yeah, but there's a different argument that was on the table this morning. Hey guys, is that just the normal sound out there, or are the mics on in there?
I think it's just sound
out there.
Yeah, they're just loud as fuck.
Yeah, we don't have any mics.
Can we ask them to quiet down?
Well, those are the guests.
No, don't ask them to quiet down.
Yeah, that's fine.
It sounds like Frank always.
All right, let's not do that then. All right, okay. So if we have Creed 2, the reason why I think that that's possible is because I don't know if you were at the conversation for this one.
Mm-mm.
That you have to aim, like the Rocky movies are very specific, right? Like the one that is the most disappointing universally is 5. Because look at those scores right there. The Rotten Tomatoes score 27% for Rocky 5, but Rocky 4 is 38%, but the fans love Rocky 4, mm-hmm. right? Now, Rocky 4.
But do critics love Rocky 4?
No, they don't. It's clearly, you know, right. with the 38% or whatever it is. And the reason, what I'm saying, that's why I believe that that'll be the same thing for Creed, because the difference is when a Rocky movie really delivers. Rocky movie really delivers when the story, it can just be okay, but if you deliver in the ring, fans will take it out going, thank you very much, right? And so that's Rocky V didn't have that. They had a street battle, and that's why it bombed. But Rocky IV was essentially the movie itself is a music video and a stupid robot.
Why do you think that Creed II, from what we've seen from the trailer, I feel like Creed II is going to be even better than Creed I. Just Creed.
I certainly hope.
I 100% agree.
Yeah, I hope that you're right. Yeah.
Which has a 95, is it?
Well, yeah. The first one is 95. Yeah. I think that there's a certain.
Have they seen Creed?
Who?
Perry.
And they liked it a lot.
Oh, they've seen it and they think it's going to be panned.
Yeah, because here's the difference.
Well,
they're not hardcore
then.
Rocky fans too, like you and I. I don't know. You're a hardcore Rocky fan.
I really like Rocky.
I've already requested me be your +1 for that.
Is Roxy talking about the new one? Have they seen the new one?
Yeah.
Yeah, they've seen Creed.
She's talking about Creed.
They've seen the new Creed.
Yeah. They have. Yeah,
not
they
Creed have. 2.
Not Creed 2. They have not seen it.
She's talking about, she means the original Creed.
No, I meant Creed 2.
Creed 2.
No, they have not seen. No, thank you, Beardo. No, they have not seen it yet. No. So that's, the point is that what I said was I don't care what the non-Rocky fan thinks about this movie. Mm-hmm. I really don't.
At all.
I don't care. Like, I mean, I want it to do well financially, and if it does well, then I can get a Creed 3. But this is a movie to me that if you're hitting the core fan base, and if I walk out going, that was great, that fit inside the franchise, and if it's like a UFC fight to where you build up, the whole entire movie is a preview, a build up to the fight, and then that fight delivers, I'm in.
Yeah,
I
this be is supposed yeah. to be for us. Honestly, this one's supposed to be for us.
Yeah, it's going to have references to Rocky IV. Yeah. It's, I mean, that's the thing is that you look at it, Rocky, so this is why I agree
but
with
I don't,
him.
I don't think it's going to be shoehorned. Like, the references aren't going to be shoehorned.
Maybe not.
Like a lot of sequels have tried to do, right? I think it's going to be a natural flow of a storyline from the whole thing because it does have the IP.
I agree, but this is the difference, though. When you and I are sitting, even if it's done brilliantly, mm-hmm. if you and I are sitting in that movie theater, we're going to nudge each other. And go,
oh,
that's
I know.
This. And
I
then
know.
Someone else who like Perry is not going to mm-hmm. give a shit.
No, correct.
So that's not going to have the same kind of emotional weight that it will have for us.
I agree.
Who are watching it. So that's why I think critically, it's got a shot to be the lowest. For sure. I mean, I hope it's the highest, but I don't care. I don't care if it's got 4%. If the movie delivers as far as a fight goes and I'm emotionally invested as a Rocky fan, I don't give a shit at all. Now, I didn't love the fight, the end boxing match in Rocky Balboa.
Yeah, I didn't like it.
I didn't like they try to get the realistic HBO boxing. I want them to stay away from that. I want them to go back to what they did in Creed, and it went back to the Rocky style of it looks like people could get hit in the face with a crowbar and still be okay.
I think the only movie where the HBO boxing look makes sense is The Fighter with Mark Wahlberg
absolutely.
As Mickey because it's I mean it's true to life, you know what I mean? Yeah, and it looks amazing.
But even then, even that fight wasn't.
Yeah.
That wasn't even boxing style. That was more Rocky than anything else, too. Yeah, and that's why it worked. You don't want to see it. I'll turn on HBO and watch that shit, or I'll watch it on YouTube.
Yeah.
I don't need to see. I want to see the Rocky fights. The Rocky II fight is one of the. I mean, Rocky gets his ass kicked for the majority of the fight, but it's so silly, but great.
Yeah.
That they they hit each other and they both fall down. It's dramatic. It's for movies. That's what I want to see. So. Yeah. I want them to beat the piss out of each other in this movie.
I keep seeing the trailers for the Fantastic Beasts movie, and I'm on the polar opposite of everybody else. I walked out of Fantastic Beasts like that was 2.5 hours. I'll never get back. It was just so boring.
I was just bored
by that movie.
No, I thought it was better than he did, but I don't feel the same way you guys did.
Right.
Okay. And then this one, I just don't know where my passion lies in this one. I loved Harry Potter, but this one is just, I don't know.
What is that?
It's a silly snoring. Sound effect.
Okay. Yeah. It's that movie, I don't think that Fantastic Beasts got enough people and enough people excited about a sequel to make sense.
But
were you
a Potterhead?
Yeah, diehard.
Oh,
I read
really?
All the books.
Okay.
I love Potter.
Right.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay.
Well, that's why I think you're going to like this one.
Yeah.
I think you're going to like because from what everyone's been saying, this connects way more to the Harry Potter universe than the first one did because the first one just happened to be have magic, and then there were some references, but this actually ties into the rest of the franchise.
You got Dumbledore coming, it is tying, I think, to the Horcruxes that are setting it up. Maybe.
Do you guys think that instead of going back, if they had gone forward, it would have been a more successful franchise?
Wait, it started with Fantastic Beasts, and then Harry Potter.
Exactly.
No,
nah.
No, because Fantastic Beasts was the book that he studied. In the movies, right? And then she released that book, and I was a Potter fan, and I grabbed it, and I'm like, it's fine. It's a fun table book that you get to your niece later.
Does he study Fantastic Beasts inside of the Harry Potter movies?
What? Yeah, there's a class on, and the book that they study is
Newt's
is his book.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And Hagrid talks about him all the time.
Yeah,
Hagrid talks about Newt Scamander.
He talks about the
Newt
book.
Scamander is the book is a textbook in their studies.
See, look at me. See, I'm not. I love the movies, but I'm not. I wouldn't ever call myself a Potterhead. Not because I don't want to be. Because I don't recall all the information. I'm not. Emma Fife or Rachel Cushing, like they would know. Like that's who you talk to. You want to know stuff about that. I love when that movie comes out. We got to get one or both on the show to talk about all that shit. All right, so I don't have to ask if our guests are here because I think I can hear them.
They're here,
so they are here. I'm looking forward to talking to Matthew Lillard when we get back from the break here because I'm gonna go to break early.
I want to hear your story, whatever it is.
You know my passion for Summer Catch. It's one of my favorite movies of all time.
Is he in?
Yeah,
he's in it too.
Matthew Lillard plays Brubaker in the movie. It's awesome.
How many movies have they done together?
Freddie Prinze,
Summer Catch, Wing Commander,
Scooby Doo,
both Scooby Doos. So that's four.
So funny.
She's All That.
Wow, yeah. They did five movies,
I think, yeah.
Because that's so funny. I should tell Freddie that Matthew's coming. I don't know. I think they get along. I assume five fucking movies together. You assume that they do.
Yeah.
All right. Well, when we get back, Matthew Lillard is going to be in studio. We're going to talk to him about everything. We're going to talk to him about. He's a D&D guy, man. That's why he's here. He's going to talk about his game, D&D, the tabletop game. When we get back, Matthew Lillard, live in studio.
I am the one hiding under your bed. Teeth ground.
sound sharp and the eyes glowing red.
I am the one hiding under your stairs. Fingers like snakes and spiders in my hair.
Hello, Collider fans. I'm Kristian Harloff, and you see my stupid name in the background because that's my other show. It's One-on-One with me, Kristian Harloff. What the hell is it? I just sit down and talk to people. I literally just sit down and talk to people about what the hell's going on in their lives and their careers. And it's a long-form interview show. Originally, it aired on Collider Video as far as the YouTube channel goes, but we moved it on over, and it's on the Collider Video Podcast, on YouTube. Go on over there if you want to see the video and to see the pretty faces that I'm talking to. Had some great guests over the past. And we're going to have a lot more. And there's going to be people that you, maybe some celebrities or actors and actresses, producers, writers, all that stuff. But there's also a lot of the people that you know around here. I could have Copster on there. I could have Jeff Snyder, John Rocha, Mark Riley, Roxy Stryer, whoever. And I'm going to find out more about them. Long form, and also go to Apple Podcasts and check out the One-on-One feed with Kristian Harloff. And not only is my show on there, Mark Riley, the Riley Roundtable, which is another sit-down, long-form interview show, that's also there. And when Steve Frosty Weintraub talks to Kevin Smith or George Takei, that's going to be on that podcast feed also. So if you're taking a long drive and you like those long-form interviews, pop on the One-on-One with Kristian Harloff. Give it a rate, comment, do all that because it helps the show and it makes Podcast One go, hey, you know what? Those people should get ad money.
Oh, hi, guys. It's Perry here, and I am going to tell you about The Witching Hour. It is the show that I host along with Collider.com's Haley Fouch. It is in podcast form on the Collider Factory feed, and we also have the video up and running every Tuesday for you right there on the Collider Podcast YouTube channel. We talk about everything horror. We're talking TV, movies, the newest releases. We talk about movies that are celebrating anniversaries. We've even talked about books. It's crazy. If it is scary, we are talking about it on The Witching Hour. We also have so many filmmaker interviews, really cool stuff. It's all coming your way every single Tuesday on The Witching Hour. Check it out. Collider Factory and the Collider Podcast YouTube channel.
Hey, Collider fans, John Rocha here. Look at that behind me. There it is. Collider Sports. That's right. That is happening right now. We started it two or three weeks ago. We've had some great programming on there already. For those of you that have already watched, thanks so much. We got so much coming down the pike. We're talking about NFL. We're going to talk about NBA. There's plans about NHL. Golf is in the equation now. And, of course, the Premier League show that I host with Jack Hind, that's been in motion for the last couple of weeks. And then an MMA show is on the way from Dennis Zhang, me and Jay Williams as well. For you might know him from the After Schmo show. What is that thing called? Afterthoughts. That's it. The Afterthoughts show. All those things are happening here at Collider. And look, we want to hear from you. So we want you to listen. We want you to watch. If you're a sports fan, even if you're not a sports fan, we might entertain you, teach you something new about a sport that you may not have known much about, or maybe so deep into it that you wanted to learn even more about it. We've got you covered. You can do that. Follow us on iTunes and on YouTube. You can there watch all the shows or listen to all the shows that you want, and then leave us comments and rate the shows as well and review them. And then let us know what other sports you want us to cover. Look, we're not touching rugby. I'll just tell you that right now. That's as far out as we'll go, or cricket. But maybe in the future, if we go Collider worldwide, that's certainly a possibility. But for right now, Collider Sports is there for you. Take a look at it, take a watch, and let us know what you think.
Hey guys, Riley here, and let me tell you about the Riley Roundtable. That's right, they gave Riley his own podcast. The Riley Roundtable is on its new home, and that is One-on-One with Kristian Harloff on the iTunes feed for Podcast One. It drops every Thursday. The Riley Roundtable is a little bit about everything. It's about movies and life, life and movies and everything in between. I like to have on special guests for discussions like Justice League versus Batman v Superman, for discussions about wine tasting, for discussions about UFOs, and everything in between. That's right. The Riley Roundtable drops on Thursdays on the One-on-One with Kristian Harloff podcast feed and later on Collider Video's own podcast video network. So check it out every Thursday, the Riley Roundtable. See you there.
What's up, guys? We're back here. It's Collider Live, and what a show we've had so far, but man, the show's going to get a lot better as we welcome our guest today. That's right. You hear the scream, and you know as Matthew Lillard has joined us here. Matt, what's up, man? How you doing?
Living the dream. It's good. Halloween, by the way, and nobody's dressed to scream.
Were.
So you can all just get out. If you're not dressed to scream.
Copster, my mask. Copster, I'm so shocked in the booth in the back there. I'm so shocked that you didn't dress up. No, he's a diehard.
I am a diehard fan. I very much am. Stu is my favorite character.
I don't believe you. Well, I just. By the way, this is the one day. It's like your Christmas, and you're lying to my face.
Well, I didn't know. I don't know who you like. I don't know you personally. I don't know if you're like, oh, I get it because they scream at Halloween. But yeah, I'm a big fan. I really am.
Well, how about a homage, dude?
All right, you just blew it, dude.
Damn, I'm gonna run home and grab it.
Stu has told you to go fuck yourself.
Yes, there's time. Get out.
It's true.
Booga!
Matt, before we get into, I want to talk to you here about what's going on.
I can't wait.
Your D&D. Are you buddies with Joe Manganiello?
Yes.
Okay, because we had.
How confident do you feel about saying his last name?
Joe Manganiello. I've said it. I think Manganiello is the most
pronounced. Well,
he's from
Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
I'm friends with his brother and him. I'm the one that was like, it's Manganiello.
Manganiello. Yeah. He came in. And we had him on the show, and he's
so handsome and tall.
He is.
He's real buff.
Yeah.
0% body
big guy.
Fat.
But yeah. I figured you guys would be running the same circle because he's passionate about D&D, as are you, and I want to get into this. But I have a crazy story I got to tell you before we do that.
Is this going to make everyone uncomfortable?
Yes.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Kids, turn off Collider.
Yeah, well, we'll start with 10 years ago, legit 10 years ago. It's the weirdest thing. I had a dream, right? I had a dream. Did I ever tell you this story?
I don't think so.
Do you have security?
Yeah.
It's going to get creepy.
It is, but it's a fucking weird dream. I had this dream, and for some reason, you and I got into a confrontation. I don't remember what it was. I don't know what it was about. I just watched Scream. I just know there was a confrontation, but I remember at the time I knew what it was, and I was telling people that day because we had this comedy awards thing that we were doing. And so the night of the comedy awards, I'm telling these people this dream that I had, and we're outside doing these interviews, and you walk by, legit, walk by outside of La Brea, and it was La Brea by room 5, and you looked at me, and you go, and you turned away, and I was like, that's the fucking weirdest thing after having this dream.
Really?
It was so strange. I told my wife about it this morning. I go, I got to bring this up to him. She's like, you have to. She's like, that's weird. It's really weird.
And I just gave you like a stank face?
It was just kind of a look. It was like, not. It's just kind of like, I know, fucker. I know that we had that argument. Yeah.
I see you.
And it was so, and I've never had an experience like that before, to where it's like you dream something that you know from films and TV and stuff, and then you just popped up there. So I just.
Well, wait till you see what I do to you tonight.
I'm sure.
it's going to be so dreamy, bro.
I know, I'm sure.
That dream walking
is a real deal.
you've been
fucking around, man.
It's on.
Well, thank you for hearing that story, that weirdo story. And
I don't really know how to process that. Am I supposed to? I know, bro. I'm sorry.
But
it's. Yes,
but I don't know what it is. But it's one of those things like that. What, like, why is that a universe thing, or is that just a weird coincidence?
But we've all had that awkward moment where you have a dream about somebody, guy or girl, and then you see them in the next couple of days, and you're like, I still don't.
But dude, that's different. That's like people inside of your world. This is someone I've seen in like television, film, that just for some reason popped into my head and then is there the next day.
I am so tempted to reach across this table and hug you.
Yeah. Well, maybe that's what it was.
I know. Like, it is. It might be on soon.
So that was it.
I feel like we're brothers in the dream world.
Maybe that's what it is. And we figured it out. We were supposed to meet. And then 10 years later, here we are.
What took you so long?
All right, well, enough about me and my dreams. Let's talk about you.
I'm an Aquarius.
Yeah.
I got a perfect 1600 on the SAT.
Nice.
Did you really?
No, God, no. I'm like a damn actor. You don't become an actor if you get 1600 on the SAT.
That's true.
I don't judge anybody. We just had Vladimir Klitschko in the other day. Yeah,
how big is he?
He is huge.
How tiny is his wife?
I don't know. I don't think they're together anymore.
Well, we certainly didn't bring it up at some point.
Yeah, we didn't bring it up.
That big.
She was five. She's 5 feet. He is 6'8", 6'7".
And
six,
huge.
Seven. Dude, he walked in.
He threatened me.
Yeah.
He did. Yeah.
He threatened me.
Well, you said something stupid.
What did you say?
Well, I said.
Wait, did he really threaten you?
Yeah.
Nah.
Sort of.
But enough to make you feel uncomfortable.
Enough for him to shut up.
So I said.
Which is amazing, apparently.
Yeah. I said, do you ever remember like the best punch you gave or the worst punch you took? And he goes, don't ask Bosker's worst punch. You don't remember. And then he goes, don't forget my left is closer than you think.
He said, just to let you know that my reach is long enough, I could hit you in the face from here.
Yeah.
And he just went,
yeah.
And it was great.
Heavyweight champion of the world.
By the way, maybe that's what's wrong with the world. That somebody, instead of like answering the question, threatens your physical.
And for the first 25 minutes of the interview, all he talked about was like, face your challenge. As people, we have things and overcome. It's peaceful.
I will punch you.
Yeah, I'm gonna break your face.
Everything he hits, he crushes.
But he's a smart dude. Super smart.
I want to know what the adjective is for me when I leave. What's it gonna be, boys?
I'll tell
dream maker.
Get over here. Get over here.
A coffee.
I don't care about the damn coffee.
Get over there.
That's it.
Decent hugger?
Well, no.
I'm 48 years old. That was hurtful.
There's two ways. Jason Isaacs threw coffee on the floor, and now Matthew Lillard climbed on the table. I love it. I love it. All right. Let's talk about your game, dude. We got, so Beetle and Grimm.
That's good.
Tell me about it.
It's good.
That's what I do. That's why I get messages from the Don't Be Scared.
Are you in trouble?
No. I was just talking
you
about.
You keep pointing at this corner like there's something up there. There's nothing there.
There
dude.
Was. See, they fuck with me. There was something there, and when you turn around, it's not there anymore. But we played this old message. I got this harassing phone message that I got from this girl a long time ago, and we played it on the thing. And that's why. So
you think that was harassing?
I mean, it's kind of harassing.
Yeah, it's just.
Are you harassed? Are you a drunk harasser?
Oh, yeah, she is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Are you from the Bronx, or do you just emulate it?
Boston.
Yes. Fuck off.
Oh. How dare you talk to our guest.
Hold my watch. Hold my watch.
Being called from the Bronx. I don't know. Boston.
The way you're talking is that.
I know.
I don't think I'm a harasser anymore.
No.
Were you aggressive? How many hardcore fights, physical altercations have you been in your life?
I don't know.
Oh, wow. Would you say more or less than 10?
I would say right around
10.
Right around 10.
Damn.
Yeah. Well, I told you I don't remember a lot of them. I hit my best friend when we were hammered.
Oh.
Got in a fight with her because she was trying to remind me to bring my leather jacket. And I thought that was rude.
I'm just going
to
let Matthew interview you because it's fascinating.
Do you remember the best punch you ever gave or the best punch you ever took?
Did you ever see 13?
I did not. I refuse.
Yeah.
Why do you refuse?
Suicide's a legit thing, and I don't like the glorification.
So
there was a scene where they have to hit each other. Not have to. They decide to. And I remember one time a girlfriend of mine asked me to hit her because we had done like whippets or whatever. And that was the best punch I ever gave.
Wow. Oh, my God.
She's not even moving.
It's amazing when somebody's just still.
I know.
And how easy it is to punch them.
You never got in a fight?
I wasn't really great at fighting, but no. I tangled assholes a couple times.
Yeah. Over or like, under 10?
Under 10.
Okay.
Under 10.
Yeah. Under 10. But like multiple times, I was always the guy, true story, like I would jump into a fight to break it up with people I didn't know.
Yeah.
Like I'd be, guys, stop! And like in the middle of it, because I'm big and
you're
a pacifist. Well, just sometimes it's just you have to stop.
But like, you wanted to have a good, you're the guy that wants to have the good time at the party. Right.
I'm not really. I was saying this today to a buddy of mine. I'm not really a big party dude.
Ever?
No, my. Really? It's funny because social anxiety. This is a weird story, but I'm super comfortable in this situation. I could act. I could be in front of a million people talking about something I care about. But if I go to a party, I just get super. Would rather be anywhere else but that party. Now, in the world of like, if you put me with a bunch of drama people, if you put me playing games, if you put me playing Dungeons and Dragons, if you put me like in a situation where it's kind of my speed, it's the best.
Oh, well, let's talk about that too, because again, there are certain types of people you don't like. We were just talking about with Joe. I didn't know until I got to know him that how he's obsessed with D&D and that this culture now D&D, and then I figured you guys knew each other because you guys run in the like the same circle. Did you meet him through the D&D circle?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So tell me about where did your love for a company start when you were younger? Like how did you really start getting involved in D&D?
So I started playing as a kid. Like we were that same sort of neighborhood you grew up in where you'd take off in the middle of, you know, 7 o'clock in the morning and you'd play until the lights came on. And, you know, you played football and then you'd play war and then you'd play football again, and then you'd ride bicycles to buy candy, and then at some point you'd have to come inside because you just were scorching hot. And, you know, at some point a guy named David Larson in my little neighborhood started playing Dungeons and Dragons, and I was probably 9 years old. And, look, I had a crazy active imagination, like off the charts sort of. I was a drama kid. Yeah.
Where'd you grow up? Did you grow up in?
I grew up in Detroit and then moved to Orange County when I was like 10.
Got it.
So this was in Orange County. Yeah.
Yeah, Tustin. Foothill High School.
You went there. To Foothill?
I went to Foothill, yeah.
We're the loyal knights of Foothill.
Yep. I could, yeah, when I was doing that.
This
I was
is
like
the best interview I've ever had.
There was, because
we have the Dreamweaver, and now we have like a knight,
and you
a loyal
get punched
knight.
And you, get, and you have
you were starting to appear in television, and my drama teacher was like, yeah, he went to Foothill. And
who's
we were
your
all
drama
like,
teacher?
Jan Laurie, but I don't think you had. I think she started like right after you left.
Oh, right on.
Right.
I started playing Dungeons and Dragons, and then like every normal kid that played D&D as a kid, I stopped when it was time to stop. Like when girls became a relative,
right?
You know, like oh, I would like to kiss a woman. I stopped playing, and then
In so I went to acting school for college, and my first year in acting school, my roommate at the time had all these Dungeons and Dragons books, and I was like, "Dude, do you play D&D?"
Yeah.
And he's like, "Yeah." And so one day, instead of going to a Super Bowl party, like we grabbed five guys and we started playing D&D again. I was 22 years old.
Right.
So I've been playing with that same group of guys ever since. I'm 48.
Well, and then so now you created your own game here.
Yeah.
Too. So where did that come from? How did, like at what time? So you're 22 when you start getting back into it, and from 22 on, it's active.
Yeah. I mean, not active. I mean, you know, we're still, you know, we all have kids and wives, and mm-hmm. we all have lives. But you know, it was something that instead of. Why are you laughing?
Because she doesn't have kids.
Yes, you all do. That is true. You all have wives and kids.
I don't have kids. I don't have kids. Well, I have a wife.
Wife, fiance.
No, my point is that we were like, you know, we sort of like
trying to grow up.
Yeah, we were. Sure. Yeah, we
you
were
guys
in New
all
York.
On your team.
Yeah, we were like, and 22. You know, you're trying to figure it out. We had all these. You know, we're doing all the things that 22-year-olds do. But every now and then, like once a month, we'd get together and roll dice. And so, we've been playing our whole lives. And about 2 years ago, we started thinking, you know, we're in the middle of a midlife crisis, let's face it. There's more years behind me than there are in front of me. I was like, God, I got to do something else with my life.
Yeah.
And instead of buying a fast car and getting a new wife, I was like, oh, we started thinking about things that we could do, things that we love. And, you know, we were talking about doing a mystery box company or, you know, an escape room. And, like, we have five creative guys that we all sort of come from the same space. And at some point, my buddy was like, I have the idea of what we can do. And he's my partner, and he said, we should do, you know, some people, if you love Pearl Jam, for example, some people go out and download the album. Some people go out and buy the CD, you know, used to buy the CD. Some people go out and buy vinyl now. Yeah. Like the real Pearl Jam guy will buy, you know, I love the vinyl, I'll buy vinyl. And then that rare person that is like obsessed with Pearl Jam will buy the boxed edition of, you know, of the Pearl Jam album. So we are, in essence, the boxed edition of every Dungeons & Dragons release.
I like that. I like the way you put that. That's awesome.
Yeah, so it's like, if you love the game.
We're going to start a Pearl Jam cover band. I was like, yeah, that's what I want to do.
We all got throat tattoos with Pearl Jam. So we started this company, and we sort of pitched the idea, and D&D said yes, and right now, I'm like the head of marketing and international distribution and insurance. I mean, like, you're figuring out this whole corporate structure. And
do you at one point, though, when you get that, because that's a lot of responsibility that comes in your way, especially for a product that you love.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So when that happens, at any point, do you say, shit, this is a lot that I took on, or no, bring it, let's do some more?
Yeah, it happened. Listen, our business runs from 9 p.m. to 1 o'clock in the morning every night.
Damn.
And we only made 1,000 boxes. So it's Beetle & Grimms is the name of the company, and it's Platinum Edition, and we're releasing 1,000 of these boxes. Yeah. And, you know, we're almost sold out, but until recently, we were really struggling. And we were about to have to write, like, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of checks. Oh. And
How does it catch on? What do you do to get
Oddly enough, so we do you know what Critical Role is?
Matt
Mercer?
Yeah.
So they're huge in the space. And D&D Beyond, which is a partner and a licensee of Wizards of the Coast. I called him and I said, Adam, who's the CEO and just the greatest guy in the world, I said, we're really struggling. We have this great box. Nobody's seen it because we're like, you know, we're creating things, but you can't buy it.
Right.
Because we don't have the money to make it by itself. So we're doing pre-orders. So I'm like, I guarantee you, there's 149 things in this box.
Holy cow.
It's huge. And it's $500, so it's expensive. Right. But it's worth we're hardly making any money on it. And I said, we need help. And so he threw out this email blast and put us on Critical Role, because they buy timing on Critical Role, and we sold like 400 boxes in a week.
And that's what he does. Well, let me ask you a question too, because even when
is this interesting at all? Or
No, it's very interesting.
Should I make it sexy? I don't know.
No. I'm interested because I've always asked Joe and Nick, which is maybe where you were asking, is where is the Dungeons & Dragons TV series and where is the Dungeons & Dragons movie?
Well, yes, that was one that I want to get there. I want to get there for a second, but kind of going into what you're saying here because this is the one question that I had. I'm always fascinated because I played there was a wrestling role play game I played when I was a kid, and I loved it. I am so intimidated when it comes to D&D, right? Not because I love fantasy. I love like all the stuff you guys are speaking my language, but I'm intimidated at how to get into it. Because like you said, you started when you were younger. You got back into it when you're 22. Sure. I've never played a lick of this stuff. So like if I wanted to play again and I wanted to get into your game, like is it something I got to get into the minor leagues first, or how can I get into it?
It's a great question. First of all, I would say this, that in the world, you know, we're talking earlier about how the world feels like it's going to hell in a handbasket. There's something about the D&D culture and the world and the community, which is a huge word in D&D, that is unparalleled. The acceptance and the sort of openness of every level of play, every way you play, every gender, sex, creed, queer, straight, trans, doesn't matter. You're accepted in this community. Love so, that. Which it need, like the world needs, right? Yeah. And like yeah. you look at Matt Mercer just did this thing called Between the Sheets, where he talks about D&D is the world that people like me that were lost in the world, I found drama and it changed my life,
right?
But there's people still in the world right now that are lost. And there's something about finding community in the Dungeons & Dragons world that like solidifies you. You want to run through life with people like you. And you find a game and all of a sudden you're surrounding a table like this and there's five of us and we're like, we're all joined in a story and that is community. It's the same thing as going to church. Like you're like, oh, these are my people. And having people make the world makes the world a much better place. To your point, you can get into any game because all you have to, it's so easy. The access level is like you need to buy 3 books.
Okay.
Collectively, it's $90. If 5 people are playing, 3 books, $90, is not that hard.
Right.
You grab some dice and you start playing. Literally, if you grab a 12-pack, somebody reads the Dungeon Master book, learns how to play. You can be off and running in this game and have the next, you know, the rest of your life surrounded by people you love telling a story and like doing acts of heroism. I mean, the thing about Dungeons & Dragons is that you're just telling a badass story for years at a time.
Right. Well, getting to what Josh was saying there too, because what I've seen now is this kind of boom in D&D and popularity.
Huge.
Because of guys like yourself and there's, it seems like there's a lot of like celebrity endorsers that too. And not just because it's a fun thing to do, because you legit love it.
Right? I think Stranger Things helped too.
Stranger Things definitely helped.
There's no
sure.
doubt that it's in the zeitgeist right now. Stranger Things definitely helped. There's a release of the core books that 5th edition has been an incredible asset to people that play. It's like there used to be a thing about Dungeons & Dragons that was kind of complicated, and now the core rules that they run is relatively easy. And it doesn't hurt that Joe and people like me and Deborah and Wall, like there's a lot of people out there that are sort of finding the place. But and like at the front of, you know, flying our flag proud and saying we play D&D, which makes it okay for kids somehow. But I will say this, that I think in our culture, there's a emptiness to online sort of activity, right? Yeah. It doesn't have the same, if you spend hours on Facebook, you're like, oh God, I feel nothing. You sit around a table, you vanquish the bad guy, and all of a sudden you're like, yeah! Like there's a legitimate, there's a legitimate rush.
Yeah.
That's the thing that's making it badass. People are like, oh, I actually am getting nothing from that. And you get a little, I mean, board games all over the place are screaming through the roof. I mean, there's been this renaissance of board games. There's been a renaissance of coming back around the table and playing cards and being with your friends. That is, I think, a result of a left turn of what's happened on social media and technology. And
yeah, it's also character investment too, right? It's investment inside of what you're doing, the fact that you're with all your friends and you guys are world building and you're...
Yes, you're telling a story, dude. Yeah. It's like you're sitting there. It's like the foundation of civilization is sitting around a fire and telling stories about how you killed a dinosaur.
Right.
I mean, this is the same shit.
Right.
And you're doing things like, I killed the devil. I mean, you're like, you know, you're playing a paladin. You're building these badass characters doing badass things. And it's like, you know, this fantasy element that allows your imagination. When you light an imagination up, like when you light a kid up or you light somebody up like, oh, that was awesome. Like, that's visceral.
Right.
When you sit around this story and you're like, yeah, and like, that's, you're having a visceral reaction. That's doesn't happen on Facebook.
Right.
What about something like MTG? You think the communities are very different from a Magic Gathering to D&D?
Oh, no, but I don't. So the interesting thing about Magic is that you're sitting across from a dude trying to beat someone, right? The interesting thing is like, the thing that kids love about it is you're collecting cards, you're collecting powers, but then you're competing. Like our world, like, you know, at a certain level, you stop competing. There's something about trying to beat somebody across from you and shaking a hand at the end of it going, dude, that was awesome.
Right.
As a spellcaster. It's the same thing as people in MMA want to be physically fit. They want to kick ass. They want to win. But it's competition, right? It's a natural, humanistic, I want to win.
Right.
That's the same thing with magic. It's just a cerebral. If I cast this and I cast this, it's like, you know, it's
like,
I don't know,
puzzling
it's
your chest or anything.
Yeah, well,
like that.
Yeah. Yes, well, that's why when you go into storytelling, and again, because you guys are who you are, and because you're a creative dude, and you're always kind of thinking, and when it comes down to the TV and film element of it, I'm sure that the conversations come about. There's two things. One, the conversation always used to be, I'm sure, the movie, because the movies in the past haven't been fantastic, but like now, with streaming, and now with, when you look at like the Star Wars show that's going to come out, The Mandalorian, right? You're going to have 10 episodes to really
tell a story.
Yes.
Yeah,
and
it's
now,
the best.
Now, I personally think that if you're going to do this in Dungeons & Dragons, that's the way I believe that it should go. I think you want to go down that direction. Where do you stand on it?
Well, look, I think that if you look at Game of Thrones, right, the ability to tell the story at a high level with quality is unparalleled, right? Like, nobody ever took the genre seriously. Spell casting, heroes, you know, dragons. The genre was never serious until you see the success of something like that. So there's no doubt. And by the way, that's another piece of like D&D success. So there's no doubt that streaming and telling the story in 10 parts seems to me the best way to sort of do it.
Yeah.
The problem is, and the thing you have to crack in doing this, is that Dungeons & Dragons isn't like the story of Conan. The reality is that I'm a guy who plays D&D. There's a separation between me and the character.
Right.
So I think that to me, that's one of the hard things to crack. Unless you're doing something like Jumanji, like all of a sudden, now I'm in the game.
Right.
Like, I don't know how, it's sort of like, they've got to sort of crack that nut.
Yeah. Well,
and I know they're on it. I mean, obviously, it's at all-time high. Like, D&D has never been hotter. Exactly. It's never been a better product. There are millions and millions of people playing in like once a week.
Well, would you want to be involved in now because you are?
Dude, look at me! I will be involved in anything this side of your home film.
You haven't been involved in anything yet, as far as talks or anything. Okay, cool.
But it's out there. I know that it's out there.
All right. So for people who now are very interested in what you're doing here now with Beetle and Grimm, what else should they know about it? Where can they get it again? So for people watching live, people watching on the replay here, and then they want to get involved in D&D, what do they do?
Yeah, well, so a couple of things. So BeetleandGrimms.com is, we're pre-selling the box. We still have boxes left. We have very few boxes left at this point. But so you can go to Beetle and Grimms and you can buy it. It has a list of everything that we've just posted, a list of everything that's included in the box. So BeetleandGrimms.com. And then, look, D&D, like, you can go to any game shop anywhere USA and you can pick up a game. Like, right now, Mox Boarding House in Seattle has two huge facilities that they're, like, running restaurants out of, that people come, they sit, they drink beer, they play board games, and then you sit down and play these, like, one-off or these one-shots of D&D.
I know at Nerd Melt, because that's where I live. I live, like, basically right behind where Meltdown Comics used to be.
Yeah, sure.
They had a huge D&D thing there once, once a week, basically. And when they shut down Meltdown Comics, they kept doing it just in the alley behind the building.
Oh, really?
They'd
hilarious.
Bring the table.
I guess
hysterical.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Well, cool.
Those people need houses. They need housing for that.
That was their community center. Yeah, yeah. And it's a shame that they tore that down. It's just, it was too expensive for everybody to run it out of there.
Right.
It's incredible to hear your passion on it.
Like, I'm not leaving. I feel like you're about to leave and wrap this up.
I'm going to shift a little bit, though, but I'm not going to kick you out.
Okay, let's stop talking about D&D.
Shifting.
Let's talk about chicks.
I do.
She'll
do it.
Totally
wrap.
Let's do it. No, because your passion is legit, and you can tell. And again, when you see, when that's the thing, the reason I asked that question, how to get involved in the first place, because we do this thing, and I bring it up all the time. We run this trivia league here, right?
Uh-huh,
and I'm like, I'm obsessed with it because I run the damn thing, but people respond to it because of how passionate I am about it. And you can tell that's the stuff that you're able to, because you're not bullshitting, you're not trying to sell anything.
No,
you're trying to bring people in to expand the community.
Yes, and I have no idea why we're doing this.
Right.
I want you to know, like, we're not making, I mean, look, I think that there's a way to make money. I think there's a way to serve the community and do both.
Right.
We are not doing that now.
Right.
Like, we're like, you know, we're five middle-aged white dudes going, well, this is better than, you know, getting drunk and getting a new wife. I mean, we're sort of like, I don't know. We're doing it for all the right
reasons. It's definitely healthier.
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, well, it is. So I do want to ask, because cops, I'm assuming you haven't left the place.
No, why would I leave?
I know you wouldn't leave. I want to give you the opportunity.
Because you were supposed to go get an outfit, bro.
don't you think you should come in here and ask the questions? I think you should come in here and ask the questions.
Wait, he's on his way in.
Can he open the door? Because I'm about to sweat my balls off.
Yeah.
He's coming in.
It's hot.
It's been brutal in here.
Nothing free
freaks me out more than a dude.
That is amazing.
Grown ass man.
Yeah. Well done.
By the way, you had Freddie on earlier, and now you have that.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Hey, Wes Craven.
Yeah. No idea.
We're staying in universe. Was it in your car?
It was really good.
I don't know. What are you talking about?
Yeah, he was wearing the whole time.
You're really creeping me out. You're really...
That's incredible. Is there a breathing tube?
You want to get out of here now? Yeah. Well, Cops, I want to give you the chance here, too, because I know how big of a fan you are of Scream. I want anything. This is your opportunity. You got a chance to ask him anything you want.
I will tell you, I have not answered a Scream question in...
15 minutes?
That's not true. I do these cons.
Are you going to say a
day? No, I do these cons and then I answer questions.
Yeah. Do you get tired of it after a while?
No, it's not at all. I mean, it's like, you know, a part of your history. But I've likened it to being like, ask questions about your first girlfriend.
Right.
Oh, yeah, she was great. I loved her. She was awesome.
It doesn't define me, bro.
It's also I have a wife and I have three kids. Right. Like, it's not, you know, it's like, I have nothing to say. I mean, what else can I say about it?
But on that note, why don't you ask him?
What do you got now?
What was it like? Who killed Tatum?
It was funny. Because Dreyfuss was, we had Dreyfuss in here, right? And I asked, and before he gets in here, he's like, there is nothing that you can ask me about Jaws.
Yeah.
Someone has not asked.
Oh, I love it.
And it's like I think we actually did, but he didn't admit it. So, all right, go ahead.
Did you like him?
Dreyfuss?
Yeah.
He was a character, man. Like, I had him. We were supposed to have him on for 45 minutes. We had him on for 2 hours and 15 minutes.
Oh, that's a good question, though. Did you like him?
I did like him because I'll tell you why.
Do you like about guests?
Honesty. I like. I would give you a very positive review.
I'm working on it. Yeah, I'm still working.
No, it's just because the thing is, to honesty and people who are just
get out. Get out.
I would want you back in to talk to you for like an hour to 2 hours. I figure we would just shoot the
show. I'm not leaving. What are you talking about? I'm staying.
So look, you stay for as long as you want, man. I'll stretch. Like my thing is, as far as to answer your question, I like when people just have conversations, like very similar to what you're talking with D&D. I mean. Obviously, I want to get to what you want to promote. Obviously, I want to get like other questions about things that you've done. But I just want to shoot the shit. I want to know, like, you know, I would go to, I could hang out with that guy. I could have a drink with that guy. That guy was intense. That lady was legit.
Crazy.
You know, but that kind of stuff. Like, and so when Dreyfuss sat down here for like two, like, I asked him, maybe I was going to talk to him about all these lists of the movies that he did.
Sure.
We talked about his movies out of that 2 hours and 10 minutes for maybe 10 minutes. That dude just went on a ride, and I just went
followed
with him.
It. Oh,
that's
good.
That was it. So that was kind of the thing. So anyway, so go ahead and ask your question.
Sitting up. Well, I didn't want to bring the mask because I figured you heard 1,000 things about it. I didn't want to be like, but I had this in my car. I was waiting for you. Anyways, but
that's so fun.
I love your freak flag.
Yeah. Well, now that I'm on the spot, not to get too personal, but you obviously worked with Wes Craven, and he has passed, unfortunately.
Wait, what? He's dead. That's not funny. God bless you.
I was just going to ask what it was like working with the man. What was it like working with the man?
I would say he was amazing. He was an amazing dude.
Yeah.
He was so quiet. He was so simple. I one of the things I love to say and tell people is that he was an ornithologist. So he loved the study of birds. Like, he would go anywhere to watch birds. I'm making that up. I don't know if he would. but he was an ornithologist. Like, he loved birds. And so, I mean, you look at the sort of the nightmares that he created, and the humanity behind him was fantastic. It was like you would never put those two together.
Right.
And, you know, we got him. I mean, the thing about Scream is that people don't really realize that the movie it was from a director at the time that hadn't had a hit in a while. It was a genre that was, for all intents and purposes, kind of played out and dead. And we came out Christmas Day. So the idea you know, and it came out, it didn't make a lot of money opening weekend.
It was word of mouth that kind of kicked
its ass. Yeah, so at some point, Wes reached out, or we were having a conversation, or we went to dinner or something, and he said, "Congratulations on the movie." And I was like, "What are you talking about? We didn't do that hot."
You thought it was a bust when it first came.
Well, the opening weekend, like, it used to be the day when you would have to call a phone line and they would have a recorded box office.
Right.
Like, there was no such thing as the internet. I know this is going to freak people out, but I don't even know if we had cell phones.
Not around that time.
Not that clear. So opening weekend, we thought it was a bust. And he's like, they've never had exit polls as high as this. We have a hit. And we're like, what? And cut to like a month later, we were having a $100 million party
you know, like sort of at this Mexican restaurant all together going, that was crazy. So in doing the movie starred Neve Campbell and Courtney Cox, and you're like, two people from TV, right. That doesn't work. Like, that's not how movies used to work. You're either a movie actor or a television actor. And those two women as stars, like, oh, nobody's going to see this shit. And it's Wes Craven, and it's a horror movie, blah.
Right.
But it was special in that the script was incredible. The ending was sort of like, if you watch the beginning of that movie with Drew and the end of the movie's exceptional. Everything in the middle is fine.
Yeah.
But everything in those two, like, you get them and then you leave them in like this really intense way.
Yeah. And that was it. So, well, you know, and what are they doing? A TV show? Is that what they're doing now?
They're doing a TV still show now. TV show.
So, yeah. Look, maybe I'm the guy in the room. I think it's unnecessary. That's my point of it. I don't know if you necessarily need it, but I think that that's what they do, right? You build a franchise, and that's after the movie was successful. And did you see?
I've never seen it.
You seen the other ones?
The other movies, yeah.
You made a cameo.
I was still in that world. Yeah, I was still in that world.
Okay,
like I was still.
Yeah, because are you a horror guy in general?
No, not at all.
Me neither.
Not even.
So I'm more like, so you like fantasy and sci-fi and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not really.
Wing Commander.
Yeah. Dude,
Hack the Planet. I mean, let's just go down the list, bro.
Let's do it every day.
Let's go.
Summer Catch.
Summer Catch is my favorite. I mean, I swear to God.
I live for Summer Catch.
We have got to get you a hobby. We've got to find something for you.
Well, because the funny thing is, so we do another show, a Star Wars show called Jedi Thanks. Council, right? So Jedi Council, what?
Have you had Freddy on?
Many times. So Freddie now, that's where I was kind of going with this, is that through that, people, because he was doing Rebels, you know? So then people started tweeting out at him that he should do it in the show. And Freddie's like, stop tweeting at me and I'll do it. So he did it, and he and I became buddies. He's been on the interview show that I was just telling you about. And then we were going through your list. You've been in 5 movies with
him.
He's the most zen dude that you could possibly meet. He's such a chill dude.
Yes.
And like, so I'm assuming it was like, well, they obviously get along because they've done 5 fucking movies together. Yeah. Have you guys become tight?
Well, I will say that if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have done half those movies. That's not true. We did Wing Commander together. We became boys. And then I came back, and then I don't know if it was him or the studio for She's All That.
Yeah.
And they're like, hey, come do this. I'm like, yeah, fine. But I needed a job. I didn't have a job and I hadn't been working. And when Summer Catch came along, I went in and auditioned, and Mike Tolan, who's the director, was like, great audition, you're too tall.
Oh, wow.
I'm 6'4", so I was like, wait, what? You can be a tall catcher? And because I play catch in the movie. And I actually sent Mike Tolan 3 telegrams, like old school telegrams. You have a telegram, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
So I sent him 3 telegrams, and the first telegram was like, the best movie catcher ever was John C. Reilly, and he's 6'2". And then I was like, I listed like the height of like all these...
Yeah.
Hall of Fame catchers, and then I was like, dude, put me in the movie, I will crush it. And he wrote me back, he's like, you're by far the best actor we saw, but you're too tall. And I called Freddie, I'm like, dude, I need a job. I was broke, and I was like, I need a job bad. And I was about to get married. And so Freddie like made that happen.
I can see it. He's a good dude, man.
He's a good dude.
I love Freddie. Well, good. That's good. And the other thing that I was going to bring up to you too is one of the movies I thought you kicked ass in that was The Descendants.
This is like my favorite conversation ever.
Yeah. Well, The Descendants
started with Foothill.
Yeah. Foothill, man.
We're ending on Descendants.
Yeah.
Yeah. Descendants was awesome.
You guys shot that in Hawaii?
Yeah.
Okay. Too. And then because that movie kicked my ass when I saw it, man. Like, and especially, it was just, it's powerful. It's a very powerful movie, especially with family and everything.
I think it's, you know, I'm in it.
Yeah.
And we lost the Academy Award to the silent movie. What was it?
The Artist.
Yeah.
Did you think you had it?
I don't really. At the end of that whole thing, I'm like, dude, it's so gross.
It's so gross.
I mean, you look at George Clooney and like turns out an incredible performance.
Yeah.
And nothing against the guy in The Artist, but it's just not even the same world.
Yeah.
It's not even the same world. And that movie, The Artist, was all of that, and it deserves credit.
Yeah, yeah.
But all of everything in the Academy Awards is garbage. I mean, it's people buying votes, throwing parties, giving gifts, throwing more parties. It's garbage.
Yeah.
So every time you're watching the Academy Awards, just know that there's so much money behind the politics of what's going to win.
You're tuned out. You don't get it.
It's just so gross. And like the idea that even within all of that, like George Clooney in that performance was unparalleled and gives one of the great performances in American cinema. Yeah. I think if you look at that movie and you look at Alexander Payne's work, that movie will stand the test of time. If you turn it on right now, it's an unbelievable film.
I love that movie. And Shailene Woodley, who really, that's where the stamp from her really happened. Yeah. I mean, she was on, I know, the television show, but that was the one I said, who's this?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Now she just blew up.
She was in, you know, she's swimming underwater. She's crying. You're like, oh my God.
Yeah, do you think if people voted for Oscars 10 years later that...
Ooh, that's interesting. Like the retrospective Oscars.
It's better than the silly thing they were going to do, the popular vote.
Yeah.
Popular film. They got rid of it because they knew.
Oh, did they really?
Yeah, they were going to do it. And then because it was a big backlash because it was essentially the only way they were going to get like a superhero movie nominated, right? Because Black Panther this year, everyone was talking about it. So then what they did was, oh, we're going to do the popular film. It was like, no, consider it for the best picture or don't do it at all.
Right.
They're just trying to get people to watch the show.
Yeah, and I think that that's. You know, I don't think that people. Yeah. I just don't. Look, I think that there was a time for the Academy where this is going to. Keep me out of the Academy forever, but there's a time for the Academy Awards that people came together to celebrate film, and I still think that that is the idea behind the Academy Awards. Right. But there's so much celebration. There's Twitter. I mean, you're always inundated with like awards, and it just doesn't have the same sort of impact.
Well, it's
not
very different from what people say about Comic-Con, right? People say Comic-Con was started in the 70s and stuff too about just the love of comic books,
right?
It has since not been about that. Like
that's totally true.
If you go to Comic-Con now, one of the things I love going about Comic-Con are the parties, right? And that was never a big thing back
then. But even then, the parties are like, it's still like, you look around.
I go for the free food and free booze.
That's fine. Yeah, I understand. Yeah, yeah. I see that. I mean, I can see that in your face.
Yeah, it's true. Still,
I've seen you on the streets.
It's right there. That's why you were judging me 10 years ago when you saw me. I was like, oh, stop drinking,
dude. He's drunk. No, but it's so gross.
Yeah.
It's so gross.
It just happened.
I mean, corporate America is killing us all.
Well, you got one more?
Oh, no. I mean, I'm a TV guy, and I loved you in Bosch. Oh, I thought your turn in Bosch was fantastic.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
So, but D&D is really where, before we let you go here, too, D&D is really the focus right now?
I mean, I have to say that I am on TV. I'm on a TV show right now, which I should definitely plug, which is called Good Girls on NBC.
Okay.
That show, we were good last year, and this year's show is... off the charts. It's not on yet. We'll be on in early spring.
Christina Hendricks and Retta.
Yeah. So good.
I started in a stand-up comedy with Retta.
Oh, you did?
Yeah,
Retta
is a friend of mine, too. And Retta and I were in acting class together when we were younger, too. And she is
incredible. She did a scene last week. I'm like, well, she deserves an Emmy.
If you want to see Retta incredible, go watch her do karaoke at Barney's Beaner on Sunday night. Her and I have done karaoke together many a time.
Oh, really?
And ask her about her opera bits she used to do. She used to do this thing where she would be driving in her car and she's like, she got this judgmental looks from people that she thought people would just assume she was jamming out on hip hop. And then she would roll the window down and it was opera. And she was like a belted out opera. And she would look at them and you know how great she is. So dedicated to it. And she just nails it. And it crushed every single time.
She's so hilarious.
So that's
unbelievably talented.
So talented.
Funny, and like you're like, wow, on a dime, you can do that.
Yeah, I need to get her on here.
See, when does it come back?
I think we're back in January.
Okay.
I'm not really sure.
Season 2, Good Girls, and you have, we have the game, Beetle and Grimms. And dude, thank you. You got to come back. I would love to have you on one-on-one, which is the full interview show where we can just shoot the shit for a while because you're fascinating.
Do you like doing podcasts? I mean, it's not podcast. What is that? It's like
it's
podcast.
I think it's both.
This is audio and this is live on video too. But the answer to that question is I like stuff like this.
People are watching right now.
Yeah, we're live right now.
You can see me?
Yeah, they can see you.
Go back to work.
They're probably working right now.
What the fuck are you doing? You're what's wrong with America.
That's it.
Turn that camera off.
Sons of bitches,
Son of a bitch.
But yeah, so the answer to the question I do, because I get a chance to talk to people and hang out with friends and bullshit this particular way. So other times, not so much. But this way I do.
He doesn't do anything. What is he doing here?
I don't know who
he is.
Is
he being paid?
I just show up with Scream costumes and Ghostface.
That's what he does. We have him dress up.
You're not going to ask any questions. All you asked was that.
Me?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. I was calling you out.
Go ahead.
What you got?
I don't want to.
Why?
What do you mean?
She's on the spot.
You're wrapping the video. I did ask. I did ask about the 10 years, and then we moved forward, and I asked a bunch of things.
I expect more of you next time. Damn it. You really let me down.
I'm so sorry, sir. Right.
Matthew Lillard, thank you for joining us, brother. We'll see you soon.
Bastard.
Guys, thank you for joining us. What a great week this week here. Thank you, everybody. Thank you to the great Jim Cummings for being on the show this week as well. And we will catch you guys on Monday.